when you think of Bill Russell, you think of what? What do you think?
Top two greatest big men ever. One of the nicest gentlemen ever. I learned from him. He made me realize I was a spoiled brat when I was complaining. What I mean by that, when I first met Bill Russell, high, jovial, giggly, and he started telling me stories I had no idea of, like couldn't stay in the same hotel with your teammates and people throwing things at you and death threats and this and that. I was like, you know what? I'm going to stop complaining, because it was for guys like him and Will Chamberlain and Kareem. They paved the way for me. Barkley, those guys, Magic, they paved the way for me to make a lot of money. So by listening to all the stories that Mr. Bill Russell told me, I just said, stop complaining. Stop complaining about anything. Don't say nothing. You make a good living because of what all these people had to go through. And he was the first legendary big man that was nice to me. Huh. Like, Kareem didn't say much. Will didn't say much. And then when I met Mr. Russell, it was a hug and sit down and I did this and I did that and I like this and I like that. He was the nicest guy I've ever met in my life, really.
And he was a funny guy too, Bill Russell, right, Shaq?
He was funny. The photograph you're speaking of, I think that was at the Hall of Fame.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, to have him at our Hall of Fame, it was like wow, because I, you know, Dr. J was my guy, and he was the only one I really paid attention to. But when I started getting taller, my father pulled me outside one day, and he just kept mentioning three names every time I went outside. You know, man, you need to play defense like Bill Russell. You need to get a, you know, unstoppable move like Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. You need to be the most powerful big guy like Wilt Chamberlain. I just kept hearing those names, and then when I finally decided to do my own research, I was like, oh, I wish I could be as good as these guys. Like, you know, like when you're a kid and you're okay, and, you know, you look at the guys that are at the apex of their career and you realize you're not even close, sometimes it gets you a little discouraged. I was like, oh, I don't know, Dad. I don't think I could be as good as these guys. But then when I was coming in, I was starting to gain confidence, and I made a call one day. I told my agent, Leonard Amato, I said, hey, I want to do a commercial where all the greatest big men are inside this plasmic portal thing, because
mm-hmm.
I want to let the world know I'm coming. And what I'm coming for, I want to be recognized as them when I'm done playing. So he made the call to all the greats, and they all accepted. I was like, oh, my God. And I got to meet the greatest big guys ever in one day on a commercial shoot. That was a Don't Fake the Funk on a Nasty Duck commercial shoot. Kareem was there. Wilt was there. Bill Russell was there. Bill Walton was there. And the legendary John Wooden was also there. That was like one of my greatest days. But Mr. Russell, he will definitely be missed. You are correct. He was a funny guy. He was a nice guy. And he just told me so many stories. And he's definitely going to be missed.
The great Shaquille O'Neal here on the Rich Eisen Show. When you said you stopped complaining and you realized that you were spoiled when you talked to Bill Russell and you heard about all the moments he had to deal with, racism and hatred being thrown at him, even in his own home when people broke in when he was gone out of the city that he brought so many championships to. Did he, when he was talking to you about his experiences, did he tell you, hey, you know, you're complaining too much, or you just gleaned that on your own?
I just realized it. A lot of times you can see the title of a book. Oh, he's a great player. Best player ever. But then when you open the book, you're like, oh, my God, he had to go through all this. So this is like the first time I met him. He was sitting down. I think he was at the Four Seasons. He was just drinking water, and he was just telling me stories. I didn't get to tell a word out. He was just, and, you know, he was happily telling me stories. But I'm like, damn, y'all didn't travel private? Man, you didn't get to stay in the hotel. Like me, every hotel I went to, I had to have the biggest suite, Rich.
Yes.
It's just how it was. And he was like, man, we had to stay at other hotels. And we couldn't drink water out the waterfront. And I actually felt bad. And these guys were the greatest players ever. And they didn't even make one-fourth of the money that we made. So I decided to myself, okay, I'm going to stop complaining. and I'm going to play hard for these guys. I'm going to let them know, thank you, I appreciate you, and, you know, whatever you need. So nobody had to tell me. I was smart enough and conscious enough to realize that, hey, you're a spoiled brat. You're not even that good yet. You get swept every year in the playoffs. Shut your face up, pick your game up, and start winning championships.
Shaquille O'Neal here.
Context of white supremacy. Gus T. Renegade in for another broadcast, hopefully to share constructive information on the system of white supremacy. Today's date, Thursday, September 22, 2022. So I have been told. Autumn official, unless I'm mistaken. Solstice and all. Katherine Massey Book Club at the C.O.W.S. Man, I wanted to read this book last month, but I said, no, I don't know anything about this racist serial killer in Louisiana, and it's Katrina, 17 years. We should go ahead and do this. Ronald Dominic has killed all of these black males, and I didn't even know about him. And this book is short. We should go ahead and read this book, and then we can get to Bill Russell. And I did put that rule in place about reading books written by authors immediately after they have passed. So it worked out perfect in a myriad of ways, even though I actually did not even enjoy Fred Rosen's book. But again, it was super short, and I still learned a lot because I didn't know about Ronald Dominic, and I learned a little bit about how white people practice deception by reading Mr. Rosen's book. All of that said, it worked out lovely in so many ways because now we are reading two books back to back on the state of Louisiana. I just said all that about Katrina 17 and all the rest of it. Well, we will get to spend a good bit of time on the state of Louisiana and the great Bill Russell. I think most people would immediately think of Bill Russell and think of Boston, Massachusetts, where he won all those titles and what have you with his professional basketball career. But he was actually born in Louisiana. So as we begin his biography, Second Wind, The Memoirs of an Opinionated Man, co-authored with Taylor Branch. Now, that's always, you know, asterisk. We'll have to pay attention. We have the sneaky white hand. He is a revered historian, as I said, suspected racist. He's written quite a bit about the so-called civil rights movement and Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and all of that. Either way, we'll be mindful for how his influence may impact what we're hearing. In fact, Taylor Branch did like a 3-hour interview with Bill Russell more recently, like within the last 10 years or so. Anywho, all of that said, Mr. Russell died at the age of 88, right at the end of July. He had a storied basketball career, but he is much more known, as we heard from Shaquille O'Neal, who is an LSU, that is Louisiana State University, alumnus, Dr. O'Neal, as he said. Mr. Russell, one of the greatest basketball players ever, undeniably, but much more known for all of his efforts to counter racism, white supremacy, and I mean, wow. This book is amazing. I wanted to read it as soon as I flipped and read just a few pages. I haven't read the whole thing, but I was, oh my gosh, it is amazing. Now I can say that I've read about the first chapter of it. Wow. Kudos to our listener who invested her time, energy, voice, narrating Mr. Russell's autobiography for us. Thank you so much. I've said for years that I loathe having to do the narration. It's so much hard work and everything. So much obliged. She did a great job, and we can just sit back and put our feet up and listen. And by the way, we were talking about just this week with Dr. Marvin Dunn about books that have become difficult to access. They're out of print and or they cost an extraordinary amount of money. This is one of those books. I think people said that they were seeing this book listed for hundreds of dollars, if not when. This was within the first few days after Mr. Russell passed, and I think this book is out of print, so I'm sure it's just going to continue to go up and up and up. I know many folks said that they had difficulty even finding a copy of this book to read. Sad, tragic, really. All of that said, again, this is an autobiography. That's really what we should be known for here at the C.O.W.S. Said that proudly for years. Coretta Scott King, Gil Scott Heron, Asada Shakur, Chris Kyle, American Sniper, Pitchfork Ben Tillman, King Richard Williams, Madiba, Nelson Mandela. It would take too much time to even list them all, but we should be known biography kings here at the Katherine Massey Book Club. With that, Bill Russell, now that we waited so long, we can say, hey, COINTELPRO victim just like Aretha Franklin. Still haven't got those FBI files on Mr. Russell snooping around, in addition to everything else that we heard from Shaquille O'Neal and what Mr. Russell will detail for us now. The Katherine Massey Book Club at the Context of White Supremacy. Bill Russell with the white co-author Taylor Branch, Second Wind, The Memoirs of an Opinionated Man. Audio segment one.
You begin to lose it,
Second Wind, The Memoirs of an Opinionated Man, Bill Russell and Taylor Branch. These statistics of Bill Russell's athletic career are well known. Twice All-American on the University of San Francisco basketball team that won 55 straight games and the NCAA championship 2 years in a row. Member of the gold medal winning Olympic team in 1956. Center on the fabled Boston Celtics NBA team that won 11 championships in 13 years, 5 times voted most valuable player in the NBA, player coach of the same team, 1966 through 1969, coach and general manager of the Seattle Supersonics, 1973 through 1977. But Second Wind is not simply one more autobiography of an athlete written with a hack sports writer and filled with anecdotes about past athletic glories and pictures of the superstar in action. Indeed, basketball occupies less than half of this book, and it would be unfair to label Bill Russell a basketball player. Rather, he is a fascinating, complicated, opinionated, cantankerous, thoughtful, funny, and sometimes profound man who once happened to play the sport for a living, and whose lively, questing mind takes nothing for granted. He is a true original, as the following excerpts from this remarkable book indicate. On himself, I am a misfit and a triple threat at that. Not only am I tall enough to make a lot of people uncomfortable, I am also Black and infamous as an athlete. No wonder I have my quirks. On our society, most of us today are like cows. We will quietly stand in any line or fill out any form if there's a sign telling us that's what we should do. As a result, the country is filled with people who either paint signs or stand in line. I don't like doing either one. On Celtic road trips, we had a gaudy, high-pressure show business life. Since almost all of us were married, it would be rude to go into detail. But if a bomb had blown up our road hotel on any given night, it's safe to say that there'd have been a large number of extra bodies in the wreckage. On race, as a rookie, I was the only Black player on the Boston Celtics, and I was excluded. Dedicated to my father and to the memory of my mother and my father's father. Author's note: this book could not have been written if there had been a gasoline shortage in 1978. Most of the research took place while we were puttering around in a golf cart with a tape recorder, or driving to and from a golf course. Sometimes it was quite a drive. At least three times we woke up in Seattle and decided to drive to a golf course in San Francisco. Once we drove from Seattle to Los Angeles and back. We formed an odd partnership for such personal memoirs. At the beginning, it was highly unlikely that the subject would even touch a typewriter or that the writer would ever put on golf shoes. Now, one of us writes newspaper columns on his own brand new typewriter, and the other messes up at golf. As in many worthwhile ventures, we started as strangers and ended as friends. Family Heroes, Chapter 1. My father is a strong man. My earliest memories of him come from days when our whole family played together in the fields near our home in Monroe, Louisiana. He worked hard in a paper bag factory, but he'd still come home full of energy and call out for my brother and mother and me. We would follow him to fields where the grass grew as tall as wheat, and the four of us would play hide and seek there, sneaking around and tackling, laughing and rolling around in the old hiding places. When it was time to go home, my father would reach down and pick me up under one arm, my brother under the other, lean down so my mother could crawl up on his back, and then run all the way home, carrying his whole family as if we weighed nothing. I remember bouncing along on his big forearm, laughing those long giggles the way a kid does when he's happy. Mr. Charlie was in charge. He had a deep rumbling voice, and he talked in proverbs. He loved to tell stories, spin yarns, and visit his family. To all our kinfolk scattered across northern Louisiana, Mr. Charlie was someone to count on for strength, wisdom, and good humor. He was big, 6 feet, 2 inches, over 200 pounds, and built like a heavyweight boxer. So people would have paid attention to him in any case. But he was also a source of warmth and laughter. People fussed if he didn't show up for a revival meeting or a family meal, and they fussed over him when he did. Mr. Charlie was like a piece of rich soil, and everybody was looking to him to make something grow. Not that he was perfect. Mr. Charlie used to drink a little on weekends out with the boys back in the late 1930s, and I remember one time when he came home roaring that he could get along better by himself. He didn't need no marriage or no kids. My brother and I huddled, terrified, with our mother, and she told us it was the stuff he drank that made him like that, and not to pay him no mind, which only baffled me more. All I understood was that something scary was happening to my father, and I felt all trembly the way I did during thunderstorms. The three of us went over to our grandfather's for the night, and when we got back next day, everybody acted as though nothing had happened. The very next weekend, Mr. Charlie came home all lit up again, but this time he laughed and hugged us and told loud jokes. Then suddenly he got mad again and started yelling about how he didn't need no marriage or no kids. My mother decided to stay with him, and she told us to run over to our grandfather's again. My father didn't like this, and he told my brother not to go and to make sure I didn't either. For a minute, we were paralyzed between our parents, and then I took off, running in a panic. My brother was right behind me and grabbed me not far from the house. Panting, he told me to keep running, and he'd pretend he couldn't catch me. Our grandfather walked us back home after we fetched him. When we got there, we saw our mother standing outside with an iron pipe in her hands. She was patting it lightly, and she had the beginnings of a smile on her face and wasn't angry anymore. Mr. Charlie was staggering around, holding his head where our mother had whacked him. He was in pain, but not too much, and he said, "That woman sure do mean business." The old man walked up to Mr. Charlie and said, "You're wrong, son. You got no call to turn on the family you took and made yourself." From then on, I never saw Mr. Charlie act that way again, and he stopped boozing on weekends. My brother and I had lumps in our throats through all this. I'm not sure it was possible for me to be any more in awe of my mother than I already was, but I remember being impressed that she didn't seem afraid of all the power Mr. Charlie had stored up inside. I couldn't understand it then, and even looking back now, I think she was probably the only woman within 1,000 miles who was a match for him. She was always amazing us with what she could do. One time we were having trouble with the rats that came out of the swamp nearby to eat our chicken eggs. Mr. Charlie spent a few afternoons waiting outside the hen house to get a shot at them, with us kids gathered around all excited. And once he gave the pistol to our mother, more or less as a joke. I expected her to hand it back to him and say it wasn't woman's work. But just then, by chance, a rat came scurrying across the field toward the hen house. My mother killed it with one shot, smiled, and handed the gun back. The rest of us, including Mr. Charlie, dropped our jaws so far we could have stepped on them. Not long after that, Mr. Charlie got rid of that pistol. I think it made him nervous. As forceful as my parents were in the town of Monroe, they were overshadowed in strength by my grandfather, Mr. Charlie's father. He was stern. He had a mean streak. And the talk was that you couldn't get very far in this world without a little bit of the old man's mean streak. Everybody I knew had a special respect for him. He was a patriarch, even to people outside the family. Not so much as a wise man or counselor, but as someone who never kowtowed to anybody. People borrowed a little dignity from the old man. He was like an oak tree. He was the oldest living Russell that we knew of, the head of the line. The rest of the family had vanished when the old man's father ran off to Oklahoma back in the 1880s, abandoning him as a little boy. He had grown up without a father during the hard years in turn-of-the-century Louisiana. It had been even harder back then for a black man to survive without holding one of the selected Negro jobs, farmhand, janitor, or the like. Mr. Charlie's job in the bag factory was a Negro job, but the old man never worked for anyone. He farmed on his own until farm credit squeezed him dry around World War I, and after that he was a drayman. He drove a buckboard team for hire. Every day he waited down at his spot near the courthouse, where people knew they could find him. He'd haul logs, farm equipment, furniture, or just about anything, and when he wasn't hauling, he was busy trading at the railroad depot. The old man didn't have much money, but he was someone you could go to if you wanted to buy or sell some chickens, and he knew how to get a little cloth from Baton Rouge or a special kettle from St. Louis. He dealt in basics and staples. He would clear your land or find you a winter coat. He knew a lot of people. But he never worked for anybody except as a free agent. It was a point of pride with him that nobody had ever been in a position to fire him. He didn't like unexpected blows, and he believed that you could depend only on yourself. The old man was lean and small compared with the later Russells. Only his hands were large, but they were really something. I remember touching them and studying them. They were smooth and hard like leather, and they seemed too large for his wrist. Those hands were known for what they could lift and carry. Everybody said that pound for pound, he was the strongest man they knew. The old man's reputation dated back to the old days when he was a champion log roller, back before trucks and bulldozers came into use. Black families in rural areas used to help each other clear land. On holidays or on Sundays, when the traveling preacher wasn't in town, all the men within 10 or 20 miles would show up in the morning to clear somebody's land. There was a lot of tradition to it. They'd cut up and strip the trees and drag all the limbs into a big pile for burning. Nobody would burn all that timber now, but back then it was the only way to get rid of it. So the men would spend all day setting up this huge bonfire, leaving the trunks and big logs for last. And in the afternoon, the women and kids would arrive for a big barbecue. While they were setting up the food, the men would have their log rolling. Two men would go to each end of a heavy log, slide strong sticks up under it, and pick it up for carrying to the pile. There was a kind of competition about it. If you couldn't hold up your end of the stick with the man across from you, the log would roll right down on your hands and you'd have to drop it. Then somebody else could try to hold it up if he thought he was strong enough. It was in these contests that the old man showed his strength. They always put the biggest and strongest men opposite him, but he never dropped a log and never had one roll down on his hands. At least that's what I was told, and I believed it. The old man was celebrated around many a bonfire. By the time I came along in 1934, the days of log rolling were gone, and soon the old man traded in his buckboard for an old pickup truck. All he had left from the buckboard team was a mule named Kate. He used Kate for odd jobs like plowing his garden, but basically she just hung around. When I was 4 or 5, I loved nothing better than to tag along when the old man was out walking Kate somewhere. I might get a ride at the end of the day if he was in a good mood, and to me, riding Kate was like riding a horse. Besides, I simply liked walking along behind my grandfather. Most of the time, he didn't say anything, but when he did, it was worth the wait. I could tell that Kate and the old man understood each other. One day, I was walking along with them when Kate decided to go off and stand in a ditch. Being an honest mule, she had a stubborn, mulish personality, and she stood there with this determined look on her face. It was as if Kate were saying, "Okay, I got you now. We're going to do this my way." The old man did everything he could to get Kate back up on the road. I watched him talk to her and push, pull, shove, and kick. A tough job because there must have been 900 pounds of mule there. The old man would get Kate's front up on the road and be cooing into her ear. But when he walked around to pull up her tail end, the front would sidle back into the ditch again. So he'd take a deep breath and start over. I was taking all this in, and I couldn't believe that the old man didn't lose his temper. After a long ordeal, Kate finally wound up back on the road. The old man looked exhausted, and the mule must have taken some satisfaction from all the effort she cost him. She looked fresh and relaxed, standing there as warm and lazy as the country air. The old man leaned on Kate and rested there for a minute or two. Then out of nowhere, he hauled off and punched her with his bare fist. Whack! Just once. Right in the side of the neck. The thud was so loud that I must have jumped a foot. The mule gently swayed back and forth groggily. Then her front legs buckled and she collapsed to her knees. Then the hind quarters slowly buckled and settled down too. Kate looked all bent and contorted, like a squatting camel. As she sat there with a vacant stare in her eyes, I was dumbstruck. Right in front of my eyes, the old man had knocked out a mule with one punch. He never said a word to me or to the mule. He just let Kate sit there for a minute. And then he grabbed her by the head and picked her up. "Okay, let's go," he said quietly. And we started off again as if nothing had happened. That sight stuck in my mind so vividly that I learned a practical lesson from it. I got into very few fights when I played for the Celtics, but every single one of them was in the last quarter, after the game was decided. You have to choose when to fight, and that is the time. The old man knew he'd have been in big trouble if he'd knocked that mule down in the ditch, so he waited until it didn't cost him anything. Then he relieved his frustration and gave Kate something to think about. For someone descended from three powerful folks like my parents and the old man, I started out in life very weak. As a baby, I was always sickly. My mother told me I had pneumonia twice before I could walk, and I was the only black baby in town who couldn't keep down either mother's milk or a formula. The doctor had to give me some sort of prescription medicine to mix in. While I was growing up, I used to hear about all the medical emergencies I'd gone through and about all the times I'd caused the relatives to gather anxiously at our house to pray over the baby, as my mother called me until the day she died. One of those crises has followed me ever since. At about the age of two, as I later picked up the details. One of those crises has followed me ever since. At about the age of two, as I later picked up the details, I began running a strange fever that no medicine could arrest. No food of any kind stayed down. After a series of trips to the local doctor, who couldn't find anything wrong, I stayed at home for 3 or 4 days while the women of our extended family fluttered around and worried. I grew steadily worse, and finally my family took the desperate step of driving me to the big hospital for white people on the road to Baton Rouge. There the doctors ran tests on me, but they couldn't find anything either. It was a Catholic hospital, and one of the nuns came by to talk with my mother and Mr. Charlie. They were all in knots, and things had reached the point that they were beseeching strangers in the halls for help. The nun listened and promised to go off and pray. My parents didn't expect to see her again, but she came back not long afterward and told them to hold me upside down by my feet. That's all she said. Hold him upside down by his feet. As crazy as it sounded, the nun had an air about her that made it seem like the thing to do, even with a very sick baby. Besides, my parents were ready to try anything. So Mr. Charlie picked me up by my feet and held me over the bed. In less than a minute, they tell me, I coughed up a large piece of cornbread that had been stuck in my throat for days. Somehow, it had lodged so that I wasn't aware of it and didn't choke. And the doctors had no way of knowing it was there. All my body's defenses had gathered to fight it, gradually draining my strength. The nun said a prayer of thanks and disappeared. My parents always said she had received a vision that saved my life. Of course, I don't remember what happened in that hospital, but I think it became part of a special bond between my mother and me. She told me the story over and over and said that I carried a special blessing. I was marked, she believed, and destined for something special and precious. More than that, she told me I was her favorite. Even today, when I think about my mother for any reason, what first jumps to mind are the memories of her telling me that she loved me more than anyone in the world. She didn't care who knew it. Everybody knew that Katie Russell was sweet on me, and she stood by me like this fierce guardian. By custom and temperament, Mr. Charlie wouldn't show much affection for his children in order to set an example of respect, but my mother always cradled and hugged me and told me I was the one she loved with all her heart. It was the best feeling there was. My mother was a marvel because she could be so gentle and yet so tough. At the time, I sometimes thought she was the best parts of a man and a woman, with none of the bad parts of either, and that these qualities were so big inside her that she might bust open. She was rich, tender, and strong all at once. If I'd run into a king or queen, I would have been proud to show my mother off to them. Once when I was 9, just after we moved to West Oakland, a bigger kid walked by our project and slapped me across the face, then kept right on going. The local kids wanted to let me know that whatever I'd brought inside me from Louisiana didn't swing much weight with them. My mother saw me get slapped and came running out. She grabbed me and took off running until we caught the guy. There wasn't any doubt about what was going to happen. She made me fight him right there in front of her. I closed my eyes and went in swinging. While the little blows were flying, one of my opponent's friends cheered him on. In the heat of the fight, this friend said something about me that offended my mother. So when the fight was over and I rushed to her for comfort, she just pointed at the friend and told me what he had said, so I had to fight him too. I won the first fight and lost the second, but I didn't care. The scrapes and bruises were nothing compared with my mother's proud approval. My mother made me feel so secure that I honestly believed nothing could hurt me. The feeling was pleasant and it was there all the time, no matter what, like a bridge between us. You could spit on it, kick it, or drive a truck over it, and the feeling would still be there. Even though I remained a little sickly and was overshadowed by the accomplishments of my big brother Charlie, everything was okay. I could do what I wanted because I was certain that my mother would protect me. I would jump right in where other kids my size would know better. I was always taking one step over the line into mischief, and my mother was partly to blame. The way she cooked was one of those magical bonuses that made her even more amazing. It was like that with her clothes, too. Whether she was cooking or putting on a scarf, she had style. After just a few easy motions on her part, everything seemed to fall into place. A complicated dish would come out just right before I'd even noticed she'd gone in the kitchen. And with just the brush of her hand, she could put exactly the right folds and curves into her scarf. Everything seemed to take on a special feeling when it came near my mother. The most seductive food was her banana pudding. It always seemed to work out the same way. She'd whip up a big round plate of banana pudding in the afternoon, leave it to cool on the table while she and Mr. Charlie went out visiting, and I'd be left alone with it. Before leaving, she'd say, "Don't you eat none of that pudding. It's for supper." Alone, I'd walk back and forth by the table, looking at it and wondering how it tasted. I knew how it tasted in general, but I wanted to know how this particular batch had turned out. Finally, I'd say to myself, "Well, she was making this pudding for me anyway because she knows I love it so much, so I'll just have one little serving," which would be gone in a flash, and I'd taste it all the way down to my stomach. When the last bite was gone, I'd run outside to play, because I knew it was the only way to control myself. But after a while, I'd come back to the house, and the pudding would still be there. So I'd eat a little bit as a reward for going so long without eating any more. I'd play a while and then eat another little bit. This serving, I decided, was my parents' fault instead of mine. They'd left me alone too long. Pretty soon, I'd have eaten about half the pudding. And then came the critical moment. I'd think long and hard, and finally I'd say to myself, "Hey, I'm going to get a whipping anyway, so I might as well eat the rest." There was always a kind of bittersweet taste to that last bite, as I suddenly became aware that nothing more lay between me and the whipping. What I had eaten would begin to feel heavy as a cannonball in my stomach, and I'd be sluggish just when I needed to be sharp to plan my strategy. Usually, this was to lock myself in the house and not let the folks in when they came home. "Come on, son," they'd yell, "open up." "You been in that pudding again, ain't you, boy?" Mr. Charlie would shout, and he'd start pounding his big fist on the door. I knew he'd set his own heart on some of that pudding, so he'd be extra mad. By this time, I'd really be sweating. "If I let you in, will you promise not to whip me?" I'd ask. There I'd be, negotiating with my parents over a whipping, all because of the banana pudding. Occasionally, my mother would go against Mr. Charlie on my behalf. Once she tried to buy me a set of electric trains that cost $14, which back then was more than he earned in a whole week. She saved and worked, even taking extra jobs as a maid for the white folks. But the money was simply out of her reach. I'll always remember how hard she tried. She agreed with Mr. Charlie about the pudding, though. No matter how the negotiations proceeded, I always got a whipping. But even whippings didn't bother me much. I had what they called a happy disposition, which meant that sometimes I was entertaining and other times a nuisance. I loved to kid around with people, even the old man. My grandfather's house was a gathering place for relatives and neighbors alike. Kids would drop by just to watch him, or they rendezvous at old Mr. Russell's place to play. Grown-ups stopped in to see him all the time, even when they were heading somewhere else. The old man lived by himself for the last 30 years of his life, after his wife died when I was very small. He didn't marry anybody else, but he did have a bunch of girlfriends. In fact, his love life was always the subject of amusing gossip, as a long string of younger women took a fancy to him, way up into his 70s and beyond. When the old man was about 82, Mr. Charlie called me to laugh about how his father was afraid he was going to have to get married to a lady in her early 40s because some rabbit had died. Mr. Charlie loved it when his father bragged and complained about women at the same time, but he knew the old man could tell a whooper or two. Now that Mr. Charlie is pushing up there in age himself, he's less skeptical of the old man's alleged feats. He draws hope from them. As a kid, I knew everybody admired the old man for the way he treated women. He'd shake his head and tell me, "Now it takes me all night to do what I used to do all night." I had no idea what he was talking about. Anyway, what got me in trouble at the old man's house was the fruit. You could count on him to have some apples, bananas, and oranges around the house for people who stopped by. And you could count on me to give it away to my friends like there was no tomorrow. Giving it away was one of the things the old man wouldn't tolerate. "You can eat all my fruit you want," he'd say. "You can eat it until you get sick, but don't give it away." I was about 7 years old, so happy and secure in my mother's love that I'd kid around with the old man. After he left the house one day, my friends had a fruit feast. We started gradually, but we built up momentum fast. When he came home, there was nothing left but peels and cores. He walked right up to me. "You've been giving my fruit away," he said. "I'm going to whip you." The first thought that came into my mind was, uh-oh, this is the same guy who knocked out the mule. So I bolted and ran. It was a split-second decision. I knew I stood a chance of getting another beating just for running and a third beating for not facing up to the first one. That's the way Mr. Charlie would have figured it. But all I could think about was the sight of Kate sprawled on the ground, and I was gone. Right in the yard, I opened up a 50-yard lead. Looking back over my shoulder, I saw him jump up and grab a branch off a tree as he went by, to use as a switch. That made me speed up. I zigzagged down to the fields of high grass where our family played and dived into a clump of the really tall stuff. But when I heard the old man puffing up behind me, I changed my mind. I decided he might have seen where I jumped in, so I started crawling through the underbrush. When I'd gone a little way, I heard him pull up at the edge of the grass and prowl around. I kept crawling, and by the time I got to the opposite side, I was rested and out of range. I stood up and looked back at the old man still rummaging around back there, then sassily yelled back at him, "You know that old T model? Can't catch the Ford V8. The old man didn't catch up with me until long after I'd gotten home. I noticed that he hadn't brought the switch with him, even though I was sure that on a matter of principle, Mr. Charlie would have let him use it right there in the house. But then the old man smiled. I knew his dark mood had passed, and there was no sting in his hand when he whipped me. He told my folks about the Ford V8, and everybody had a chuckle, despite all the talk about how they had to be stern with me. I suppose I got away with a good bit of naughtiness, but I never gave away the old man's fruit anymore. In some areas, the security I felt as a kid gave me a reputation in Monroe for bravery. For example, both my brother and I were unafraid of Hanks, which sent a shudder up the spines of most of the local population. Hanks were ghosts. There was a whole folk mythology about the powers, habits, and origins of these spirits. In those days, people were involved in the lore no less than they are in television today. If a haint appeared to old Mrs. James while she was rocking on the porch one night, the news of the event would occupy the town for days. Everybody wanted to know exactly what the haint had said and done, and they'd swap theories on the meaning of its appearance. I think the world of haints was a special kind of emotional communion over woes, questions, and severed ties going all the way back to Africa. But Charlie and I saw them as a source of practical jokes. Both my mother and father were ambivalent about ghosts. They expressed doubts about their existence, but they spent as much time discussing the latest haint tale as anyone. One peg-legged man and his fat wife used to visit us all the time and stay up late discussing haint legends. One night, Charlie and I sneaked out of bed and ambushed them on their way home with sheets over our heads yelling, "Whoo!" like haints. The enormous old lady shrieked and took off like a scared horse. But as fast as she flew, she could barely keep up with her peg-legged husband as he thump-thumped off into the night. Charlie and I laughed about that one for months. Our folks said we were too young and ornery to have proper respect for old people's dealings with haints. My mother's father, Grandpa King, was supposed to have special connections to the world of spirits. He was a strange old character, as flighty and mysterious as Mr. Charlie's father was solid. One day, he got up whistling and just whistled his way out of town. It was said that the haints would tell him where treasure was hidden, and the old man would wander off after it. Once before I was born, he had a bunch of the strongest haint believers lured Mr. Charlie to an old deserted house out in the middle of nowhere, where they spent all night digging for a satchel of money. Everybody dug except Grandpa King, who spent his time spinning tales about how the haints had assured him the money was there. When this effort failed, he left town again to follow the haints' directions to treasure elsewhere. All through my childhood, our family communicated with my maternal grandfather, mainly through rumor and guesswork. Once he did show up out of nowhere and spent the night at our house. I'll never forget how, after staying up late with the grown-ups, he came to the bed where Charlie and I were sleeping and snuggled in between us. The next morning, he was sopping from head to toe because I'd wet the bed. As I was lying there cringing at the thought of the humiliation I'd have to endure when he woke up, he bolted up straight out of a sound sleep and landed on the floor. Without a word, he commenced a lively dance, spinning around and around. I couldn't believe my eyes. He didn't even seem to notice that he was wet as he danced up a sweat to welcome the morning. Then he turned suddenly to me and said, "The next time you see me, you'll be too big to wear my clothes." That's all he said. And that day he whistled on out of town again. I only saw him once more. Grandpa King left six daughters behind, my mother and five aunties. It was said that one of the things that made him a little touched in the head was his inability to have a son. Five times in a row, he considered himself burdened with girls. And when the sixth also turned out to be a girl, he snapped. No matter how many times he was told that his last baby was a daughter, he insisted that he had finally fathered a son. At any rate, This was the explanation offered for why my fifth auntie came to be the way she was. Cammie was the scandal of the King family, because all her life she dressed and acted like a man. It was our family's biggest secret from outsiders, especially from white people. Everybody knew back in the late years of the Depression in the rural South that it wouldn't be healthy for Cammie to be known as the lesbian Negro. Some of the local white people found out, of course, but they pretended not to know. And Cammie fooled strangers, and even some who knew her for years. Once she got arrested for shooting dice, and the sheriff's deputies put her in the men's cell. She pulled it off until she had to use the bathroom. Cammie may have been a scandal to some people, but I thought she was by far the most entertaining auntie I had. She was a live wire, always telling stories about forbidden places like pool rooms and juke joints. The other adults would frown about those evil subjects, but Cammie had a gleam in her eye. Her wild stories were always funny, and she never took herself too seriously. I always liked her, and remember being disappointed that she never seemed to stay around long. The only time she ever spent a full day with our family was also the only time I ever saw her wearing a dress, and I was told it was the first time she had worn one in many years. She didn't look like the same person. She seemed uncomfortable, and a lot of her zip was missing. Wearing a dress must have been as nerve-wracking for her as it would have been for me, and it was a measure of her love for my mother that she agreed to do it. Mother had forbidden Cammie to stay with us in men's clothes. Cammie was about the only relative I knew who didn't go to church regularly, which may have been another reason I liked her. Church really took it out of me when I was little. It was an all-day affair. We'd have Sunday school and afterward a long morning service that lasted well into the afternoon. Then after a break for lunch, we'd have an afternoon Sunday school called BYPU. And finally, an evening service long into the night. The music was lively, but our choir wasn't very good. Apart from the music, I thought church was dull, especially when I was 5 or 6 years old. I could understand enough to tell whether the preacher was going to lecture or to shout fire and brimstone. If he was shouting, I'd look around to see who was going to shout with him, but this never kept me occupied for long. Charlie and I managed to channel our excess energy into sleep, but every time we drifted off, retribution would come. Thump. One of the old people behind us would lean forward and flick us on our bare skulls. Thump. Thump. Our heads were bare because for some reason our mother shaved off all our hair except for a little patch on the forehead. And this made the flicks hurt even more. The old people delivered them with their thumb and middle finger, the way you might flick lint off your clothes, and they got a lot of power from those thumps. Worst of all, you couldn't cry out at all. It seemed so malicious that I decided that old people felt self-righteous about waking me up for the Lord. I tried all kinds of maneuvers to avoid sitting in front of the hardest thumpers, but somehow they were always just behind me. Outside of church, the old people were all right. In fact, they were the center of attention at a lot of family gatherings, which we had on weekends, and at the all-week revival meetings. The traveling family gatherings were the best. Every summer, we used to visit cousins in Downsville, Louisiana, where they had a watermelon farm. The watermelon there was some of the sweetest in the world. I used to eat it all day and pee all night. I ate so much that I'd go to sleep at the supper table where, mercifully, there was no thumping. Later, I'd wake up and cry myself back to sleep because somebody had eaten my dessert. There would always be some moment, usually just after supper, when the grown-ups' conversation would turn into a storytelling session. And that's when the older people would be on stage. We must have had some high-quality storytellers to keep me there, listening, when I was free to run off and play. I heard stories about relatives who had gone to Europe in World War I, about great hurricanes and feats in log rolling, which always brought about a round of complimentary stories about Grandpa Russell, and I heard stories about the longevity of our family. One of my great-great-grandmothers lived to be 115. She smoked a clay pipe, lived by herself, and was clear-headed until she died. I don't remember hearing any stories about Africa or even about anything African. I do remember an ancient great-grandmother, then in her 90s, telling of making sacks of food for two slave boys and sending them north. I think they were her nephews or cousins. Anyway, she was raising them. The old lady would say over and over that she'd never heard another word about those two boys, and even I, as young as I was pierced by how desperate a feeling it must have been to send young children you loved off into the unknown. The old people steered clear of subjects like Africa and slavery. Their talk about race was much more immediate. There were stories about the kingfish, Huey Long, and what he might have done for the Negro in Louisiana had he not been assassinated. There were also stories about FDR, who was a source of hope, and every now and then there'd be a story about a lynching. I'm sure the adults talked about this a great deal among themselves, but in the family sessions, the topic was delicate. Usually, the tale would take the indirect form of a discussion about some black man who had disappeared. Someone might suggest that he could have run out on his wife, and someone might say that it was the Haints. But then someone else would mention that the white people might have gotten him. Most of the blacks who were lynched in those days were not killed in a way that made the papers. They simply disappeared. And the local blacks would be too afraid to mention it, let alone to raise a fuss. I remember only two family stories about local lynching mobs during the 9 years I lived in Monroe. So I suppose you could say it was done in moderation. One involved an old black deputy sheriff, actually more of a sheriff's helper, since black deputies had no authority over white citizens and very little over black ones. Anyway, he got into a quarrel with a white deputy, which led to a shootout. The white wound up dead, and the black was gravely wounded. Despite his condition and his claim of self-defense, the surviving deputy was charged with murder and taken to jail. A doctor attended him there. When an angry lynch mob gathered outside the jail, the sheriff faced them and said he would shoot the first man who stepped forward, and as many as he could after that. He stared them down, just like in the movies. That's the way the story sounded at our family gatherings, though, of course, none of the local blacks had been anywhere near that jail. To us, the sheriff was a hero, and it was felt that he stood up so strongly because he was fond of the old deputy. Of course, everyone wondered why on earth the deputy let himself get in a gunfight with a white man. Nevertheless, as we all expected, the local jury threw out the black deputy's claim of self-defense and sentenced him to the gallows. He died of complications from the gunshot wound before the execution. Stories about such incidents were generally positive and hopeful. At least there had been no lynching in Monroe, which was more than could be said for the tiny town of Ruston, not far down the road. There was a black man, was accused of insulting a white woman, and was strung up by a mob. The next day his body was found still hanging. Ruston, it was agreed, was not as progressive a town as Monroe. Most of the racial tales I heard in those days had to do with how various kinfolk had handled scrapes with white people, such as the one about how Grandpa Russell had fought off the Klan in 1917. This was when he still lived out in the country, before moving to Monroe. He was a sort of freelance farmer with numerous plots under cultivation here and there under various arrangements. Once he did some work on the halves with a white man, and when the crop was ready, the white fellow told the old man to gather the fodder and divide it. The old man said, "Sir, you can have all the fodder. I don't need it. I ain't got no mule to eat it right now. And I ain't going to do no farming next year." The white fellow got all steamed up. "Nigger," he said, "don't you tell me what you ain't going to do. I'll make you do it." That set the old man off. "Sir," he said, "you and who else?" As I listened to this family classic being retold years later, laughter would always break out at this point. Somebody would repeat, "you and who else?" in a voice filled with admiration. And somebody else would chime in, "that's right." Then somebody else might point out how the old man had said, "sir," even when he was getting ready to whip a white man's ass. We all knew the old man had broken the code of behavior at the crucial moment when he was supposed to back down, even if he had to take a beating to do it. Then the story went on about how the white fellow made a lunge at the old man, which was a mistake. He ran that white fellow right off his own land. But as the white man ran off, he yelled back, "We're going to come get you tonight." So the old man went home to move his family out of danger before nightfall. If Mr. Charlie weren't telling the story himself, he'd break in at this point to tell about how his father had come home, loaded the family into the wagon, and driven them to a friend's farm 8 or 9 miles away. From the look on the old man's face, they knew there was bad trouble, and they knew even better when he took them to stay the night with people who weren't relatives. He wanted the family hidden where no one would think to look for them. Mr. Charlie told all this with great pride. He had been only 5 years old at the time, and it was his earliest memory of his father. After dropping the family off, the old man returned to his house and waited there alone, with only his dog to bark a warning. Late that night, the clan people drove up in several cars. They cut the engines, and the old man heard a lot of doors slamming, some muffled talk, and then silence. Finally, they yelled at him to come on out and get taught how to treat a white man. The old man said, "Sir, you're going to have to come in this house and get me." So they yelled back and forth in a stalemate until somebody fired a shot, probably up in the air to frighten the old man, which was another mistake. The old man opened up with his shotgun and started pumping shells out into the darkness. He kept blasting and reloading until he heard the cars drive off. After that, nothing happened. Evidently, the Klansmen decided that this kind of fighting was not what they had in mind. There was always a feeling of release when the story ended. Mr. Charlie would say that nobody knew if somebody had been wounded that night, but that the old man had sure hit some trees. The next day, everybody saw limbs on the ground. Then somebody else might talk about how those Klansmen must have worried that the old man would use his rifle. Everybody around Monroe knew that the old man had a Winchester, which he usually carried under the seat of his buckboard. If someone really pressed him, the old man himself might clarify a detail or two. Otherwise, he just sat there. We all knew he was proud of that story, but you couldn't tell it from his face. Mr. Charlie always said that everyone has to draw a line inside himself somewhere, and that the old man had drawn his at getting whipped. He was more courteous to white people than Mr. Charlie was, more deferential in the manner of the good old Negro. He had bent with these ways for so long that they didn't touch a vital spot. But he had never bent about getting whipped. Mr. Charlie had stories of his own. Once, not long after he got married, he was working for a construction company. A grizzled, mean, black dude who also worked there had the reputation for cutting up people with his knife on Saturday nights. He drove a 3-mule team for the company, but had a habit of showing up for work late or not at all. He was late once too often for the white boss, who said one morning that apologies weren't good enough anymore, and who proceeded to slap and beat the tough guy in front of the other black employees. The tough dude didn't lift a hand, and when it was over, Mr. Charlie started laughing. Startled, the boss turned on him and demanded to know what was so funny. "Well, I thought that fellow was bad," laughed Mr. Charlie. "I've heard about him cutting people and whipping two or three at a time, but he just stood there and let you whip him. That don't make sense." "What would you do if you was him?" asked the boss. "I'd either run or I'd fight you, but I wouldn't just stand there." The boss was getting mad. Mr. Charlie was ruining his little demonstration. "Yes, you would, nigger," he said. "And you can do it right now, because I'm going to whip you." "No, Mr. George," said Mr. Charlie, like he was giving advice to his best friend. "I don't think so. If you do whip me, you'll be the best man, and I'll shake your hand afterwards, but I'm going to try my hand, and I don't think you can do it." The boss came right at Mr. Charlie, testing him, and Mr. Charlie stood up to him. When they were right in each other's faces, the boss backed off, laughing, and said he didn't need to whip Mr. Charlie because he was never late. "I didn't believe you could let that man think that he could whip you at work." Mr. Charlie would tell us when this story came up. "He could fire me if he wanted to, but what good would it do me to let him beat me bloody to make me make my own living?" And he would repeat it. "To make me make my own living." He would intone the words with outrage in that voice of his that sounded like a kettle drum and carried easily over a dozen other conversations. Not long before I was born, Mr. Charlie had a job with a mom-and-pop trucking company. The mom really mistrusted people, especially blacks, and was so obsessed by the fear that one of her drivers would use some of her gas to go off on a lark, that she measured out the gas for each trip with a measuring cup. But occasionally she would miscalculate. One night, Mr. Charlie ran out of gas about 20 miles from home, and he had to walk. He was mad. And while he was walking, two drunk fellows in a car pulled up to him and asked, "Hey, boy, can you run?" It was all Mr. Charlie could do to ignore them and keep on walking. Then one of them waved a gun out the window and yelled, "Hey, let me see you run." Mr. Charlie broke into a trot, but the gun went off. Bang! Whine! A bullet sailed by, and Mr. Charlie went into a full gallop. Bang! Whine! He swerved off the road and ran down into a culvert filled with water and trash. He yelled out, "Snakes, you'll have to move over tonight, because Charlie's going to stay here with you." When this line came, we'd all laugh. There was nothing else we could do. But back at the company, Mom hadn't laughed. She didn't buy Mr. Charlie's explanation that there was something wrong with her measuring cup. Her theory was that Mr. Charlie and all his fellow niggers showed no respect for her truck, and that if they ran out of gas, it was because they had been catting about. They deserved to walk home alone at night, she felt. So Mr. Charlie lost both the argument and his job.
Context of white supremacy. Got disgruntled. I'll share with you how I got distracted. I said disgruntled. Distracted. Distracted. This is the, let me make sure I'm counting correctly. So this is the second time the books that we've read this year. So it's Lucky, The Man in the High Castle, Essie Mae Washington Williams, Dear Senator, Absolute Madness, and The Bayou Strangler. So that's what we've read this calendar year, unless I'm mistaken. This is the second time this year we are reading a book where just as we're going along, they reference the lynching of a black male. the lynching that he is talking about in Ruston, Louisiana, is R.C. Williams. 1938, Ruston, Louisiana, R.C. Williams. They have photographs from this lynching. I'll read a little bit and I'll share the photograph. That there is why we are the biography kings at the context of white supremacy. The number to dial is 720-716-7300. The code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. The number again, 720-716-7300. The code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. The email untiljustice@gmail.com. UntilJustice@gmail.com. Listen, that white dog. Listen. Before I get super distracted, one, get my correction. It is not the solstice, it is the equinox. My apologies. Make sure we get our seasonal changes accurate. And then two, man, oh man, don't you think I missed? Jeez. Let me get my, I don't know, you pick, I guess I got to pick a Boston shooter. I got to pick somebody black. Ray Allen. How about we'll do that? Ray Allen or Sam Jones. Mr. Clutch. Man, Gus T. can let the follow through. I wanted to read this book, Second Wind, last month. Right after Mr. Russell passed, because we had just finished Absolute Madness. Said, instead of The Bayou Strangler, let's read Bill Russell book. And I said, oh, man, I did put that rule in. We're not supposed to read books right after someone passes away in case, you know, it's bad. And then we can't be critical because they just passed and all that, even though it hadn't that much time passed. But still. But we had that rule and everything. Plus Katrina, 17 years, that factored in. Because I said, oh, man, dumb me. I'm thinking, oh, man, Louisiana, we should read this. Oh, but what I was thinking centrally was I didn't know anything about Ronald Dominic and he killed all these black males. Gotta read this. Waiting a month. Now the one and only time we, in our decade of having a book club here at the Katherine Massey Book Club at the Cows, the one and only time we read a book about a basketball player, professional athlete, period, unless you count Muhammad Ali, that counts. He didn't write that book, but we did read about Muhammad Ali. We did read King Richard's bio as well, but he's not the athlete there, he's the coach, so that doesn't really count. The one time we read about a basketball player, it's about a Boston Celtic legend, and we start the book on the day the whole country is talking about the flipping Boston Celtics. Oh, poor Neil Long, but wow. Timing. Yikes. Haven't even got to the Boston part yet. All right. Share one of the folks who wrote in really quick, a little bit of their commentary. Then we'll get to the folks who dialed in. I'll get to my email or excuse me, my notes as well. One of our investors who wrote in. So he says, looking forward to reading this book again after so many years. Haven't read it since it was first published all those years ago. Still haven't found my copy of it. Dang, that's like double dang. That is many quarters, as I said before, price gouging. Chapter 1, page 4. Mr. Charlie used to drink a little on weekends out with the boys back in the 1930s. I always thought of Mr. Charlie as a pejorative term used by black people during the 19th and 20th century in regards to white males, particularly bosses. Me too. The use and abuse, self-medication of alcohol by black males, was also discussed in S.E. Mae Washington Williams' autobiography, two times mentioned. Dear Senator, the Cal's Book Club selection, when talking about her husband Julius, oh, he passed away so young. Yeah, that alcohol, sobriety would be best. Oh, we talked about alcohol last book, too, in Louisiana for black males. Continuing. Number 2, page 5. The old man never worked for anyone. He farmed on his own until farming credit squeezed him dry around the World War I and after After that, he was a drayman. This was such a ubiquitous story, including just being run off the land by threats or actual violence. This was the story of my own family. Wow. Hmm. Hmm. Wow. Let's see, that right there is, they're talking about all that we're trying to do repair for black farmers, and then they keep putting in, when Biden, when he says, oh, we're going to do our repair infrastructure and look out for the black farmers, and nah, we're not going to do that. That's reverse discrimination. We can't do that. Number three, page 13, old man, fruit feast, grab a branch off a tree, use as a switch. Oh, I remember the dreaded switch. Yes, the corporal punishment. They do the World Health Organization and many other scientists, people who study child rearing, vehemently, in the strongest terms, condemn corporal punishment in any form. We've talked about that before repeatedly. Number four, page 14, Haints were ghosts. I think the world of Haints was a kind of emotional communion over woes, questions, and severed ties going all the way back to Africa. Mother and father spent much time discussing the latest Haint tale as anyone. Maybe a form of group therapy for a group of people being continually traumatized. It also reminds me a little of what Dr. Welsing described as being open to signs from the Creator. How about that? Number five, page 17. Every summer we used to visit Watermelon. I used to eat all day and pee all night. Boy, does this take me back to my own childhood and the visits down south. Watermelon time for all. Yes. Number six, page 18. The old people steered clear of subjects like Africa and slavery. Their talk about race was much more immediate. It's so important to talk about racism with children. Can't be said enough. Number seven. Most of the blacks who were lynched in those days were not killed in those days in a way that made the papers. They simply disappeared, and the local blacks would be afraid to mention it, let alone fuss. Just like Neely Fuller Jr. said about the Black Wall Street massacre during his childhood, nobody talked about it. In fact, I'm going to pause right there. He has more notes, but I'm just pausing right there. Mr. Russell said that most of the time the black people were killed and it wasn't mentioned in the paper. I am pausing. He did mention the lynching. So this is from Pathfinder, October 29th, 1938. Mr. Russell, I believe, said he was born in 1934. Lynching number three. Americans with a special abhorrence of lynching have high hopes for 1938 as a banner year in the crusade against this most fiendish of crimes. Until last week, records of Tuskegee Institute, Negro University in Alabama. Ooh, I think Tuskegee, the syphilis experiment would have been rolling by 1938. I'll make sure I'm accurate, but oh yeah, I'd put some money down. I think that's rolling by then. No count, Nurse Rivers. Negro University in Alabama, which keeps yearly count of mob murders, showed only two lynchings in the United States this year, one in Georgia and one in Mississippi. The two best previous years have been 1932 and 1937, with eight lynchings apiece. Last week, however, a third blot appeared on Tuskegee's 1938 books. Outside the little town of Ruston, Louisiana, one dark night, a Negro dragged a white man from a parked car and clubbed him to death with a baseball bat. Whoa. Whoa. Not reckless eyeballing. Not he raped a white woman. Whoa. Wonder what happened there. Can you imagine? What did this white man do to warrant getting a baseball bat and clubbing him to death? Let's continue. When the victim's woman companion tried to flee, the assailant slugged her on the head with the same weapon. Whoa. Police suspected a 19-year-old Negro, R.C. Williams, and sent out a posse equipped with baying bloodhounds. White dog again. As they searched, three young boys spied Williams running across a field, nabbed him, and marched him to the search party. Learning of the capture, Sheriff Brian Thigpen hurried to the scene and found a mob, several hundred, marching the Negro through the woods. When he pleaded for the prisoner's custody, the sheriff reported later a mob leader pointed a shotgun at Williams and threatened to blast him to death if the sheriff used force. Finally, said Thigpen, he agreed to let the crowd march the Negro through the trees on the promise that they would hand him over on the other side. As Thigpen waited, the mob roped the suspect's neck and yanked him, shrieking and kicking, over the branch of a pine tree. Then they poured shotgun slugs and rifle bullets into his jerking body. Some of the mobsters tried to fire the corpse, but others beat out the flames so that William's fingerprints could be compared to those on the murder weapon. When the bloody scene was finished, District Judge E.L. Walker said he would call a special grand jury session to investigate. Meanwhile, statisticians added one more name to the long list of nearly 4,700 untried victims of American lynchings. Don't even know if R.C. Williams is actually the person with the baseball bat who did all of this, but R.C. Williams, 1938, Ruston, Louisiana. Worthless Negro from Louisiana, I will add. Let's see. Next, number 8, page 19, Grandpa Russell had fought off the Klan in 1917. Richard Williams also talked about his own encounters with the Klan in his autobiography, two times mentioned. Cal's book club selection, Black and White, The Way I See It. He was also from Louisiana. Page 21, everybody around Monroe knew that the old man had a Winchester, which he usually carried under the seat of his background. The Winchester rifle should have a place of honor in every Negro home. Ida B. Wells Barnett, one of my favorite quotes. And we'll pause there, get to the rest of it after we finish the second audio segment. Number again, 720-716-7300, the code 564-943-pound. Press star 61 if you would like to participate. Let's see. Folks who are with us have commentary. The folks with hands up, caller victim in New Jersey. Retired firefighter in Florida. I'll nab other folks as I see hands. Y'all have commentary? Proceed.
Yeah, Gus. Let me just step away. I'm in a noisy area. I'm in the gym. I just wanted to say, so far I'm enjoying the book. I would say black self-respect, small situations of black resistance. The narrative that, all black people just, just sat down and took a beating. My family, who came from North Carolina, we referred to my great grandparents as mama and granddaddy, two interesting people. And as he talks about the old man who stood up in resistance, it just made me think of my grandfather. You know what I mean? Very reserved man, very quiet. Seldomly talk. That was kind of like my remembrance of men of their era, and racism from as a child when I was younger, seldomly talked about, grandmother still living, migrated back from New Jersey, back to her home state of North Carolina. Never talked about racism until my sister, tragic arrangement, married a white man. And my grandmother, for the first time, I mean, I've never even heard this woman utter a curse word or even cursed us, so... She was disturbed that my sister was marrying a white man. And it just kind of, this sweet woman, you know what I'm saying, just was like, why did she do that? Why is she marrying a white guy? And but again, this is a family that never talked about racism. And it's just, we can basically compare it till today. We rarely talk about racism. So racism is something, always something of the past, something that's, 100 years ago. It's not today. So now how we contextualize racism is, police brutality, discrimination in banking. You know what I'm saying? Just these little, if it's a metaphor, just these little situations of racism. But if we had that historical context, we'll be better equipped to contextualize what we're saying. So that's what I'm getting from that story. And that's what I'm, as I kind of compare it to what's going on today. So far, the book is definitely interesting.
Much obliged. Theme, I think one of our investors who wrote in said the same thing in terms of that being a theme. Mr. Fuller said that us not talking about racism, white supremacy, not talking about it with our offspring, which contributes to those tragic arrangements, even though white people are most to blame, and even white people are most to blame for us not talking about this problem. Retired firefighter should be with us. *61 for others with the commentary.
Greetings, everyone. As I listened to the first reading, I basically was comparing it to my background with the advent of a lot of masculine influence. It sounds like that Mr. Russell was exposed to a lot of black males, elder black males. That, in a sense, could be constructive to a point. Alcohol was available because that probably was the only chemical, altering chemical that was available on a easy access part, as opposed to some other things, especially in rural areas like Monroe, Louisiana. I happen to have one of the institutions that I attended for college was Grambling State University, which is not far from Monroe. Rusty, Louisiana is only about 5 miles from Grambling. And I've been to both places a lot. Ruston, I would figure at that time was a sundown town. I would figure. I could be wrong, but I would figure it would be a sundown town. There was a majority of white people there when I was in college there. Also, families were larger. And they knew one another because they were in proximity of one another in those places. So you got the source of entertainment was for the most part, family members. Social or, you know, any type of entertainment primarily was with people who are of, you know, kindred blood, because there wasn't that much of sources of entertainment like now, like malls and all of that type of stuff, especially in those places. So you spend a lot of time around not just immediate family, but also secondary family, like cousins and, you know, aunts and that sort of thing. You knew who your grandparents were. So it was more of that around than it is today. One of the negative things, as someone mentioned, was about, I don't be nice about it, I just call it corporal punishment right now. It's almost a derivative to anything that went wrong. You got a beating, quote unquote. And I like I mentioned before on an earlier book reading years ago, I suspect that a lot of that reasoning on applying that was based on what took place with us from white people. Last but not least, there was a lot more counter violent reaction from black people than what is admitted, especially in places like that, because the black male that was, you'd have grocery store, so to hunt for, so you had to know how to hunt, and you were hunting with a firearm. So, you know, it was a lot more violent acts that was encountered upon white people in response to white people mistreating non-white people than is admitted, I would suspect. And that's all I would say for this first reading. Thank you.
Much obliged, retired firefighter in Florida. That is going to be a continuing theme as we boogie along into the second audio segment, counter violence. Counter violence. In fact, even sometimes the counter violence aspects, as he said, get ignored, minimized, so that people just think, oh man, blacks are cowards, lames. We just take anything that white people dole out. No. Even, in fact, Essie Mae Washington Williams in that book, she talked about how her parents, when they mentioned the lynching of Willie Earl, which was before she was born, there was going to be another lynching of a black male, and her dad was, or the person she thought was her dad, was going to engage in counter violence to make sure this lynching didn't happen. Stay tuned. Let's see. I'll go over some of my notes and then we'll get to second audio segment. Let's see. The beginning. Again, thanks to our narrator. Much obliged. Folks can let me know if they think it's, you know, I don't know, confusing or disruptive to have a female voice for a book that's written by a black male about a black male. That we've had that before both ways, so doesn't bother me at all. Much obliged to our female narrator. The first chapter, Family Heroes. In fact, I was reminded, one of our guests on a program some years back talked about how generally individuals that do tremendous things are generally supported by attempted families. You generally don't have individuals who don't have a strong support. I mean, that's why it takes a village to raise a child and all of that. I mean, there's logic to that. Bill Russell didn't just pop out of nowhere like, wow, this guy who accomplished all of this, lived 88 years, stood, the only other professional athlete that we read about, picture that I got to promote the program, has got Bill Russell hanging out with that dude, worthless Negro from Kentucky, right next door to Virginia. Let's see, page four. Everybody talked about that, the liquor. Now, I'm sure they had cigarettes at this time, but yeah, if you know, they're not going to have fentanyl and all the rest of it, easy access, especially not in Louisiana, you know, at that time period, I don't think. But sobriety would be best. Let's see, he's talking about his father, grandfather, lots of black male figures being talked about. In fact, he says, talking about his grandfather, he said, people borrowed a little dignity from the old man. He was like an oak tree. Wow, what a metaphor. Oak tree. And then even that reminded me of what Mr. Fuller said. What's the difference between a dignified slave, undignified, or a dignified slave and a silly one? However, in reading this and then what we heard, I said, man, I just replaced dignity, black self-respect. They would borrow a little black self-respect from his grandfather. Continuing, let's see. Next paragraph. He's talking about his grandfather. He had grown up without a father during the hard years in turn of the century Louisiana. It seems like Louisiana is always hard years for black males. Ronald Dominic, Hurricane Katrina, BP. Like, man. I don't know when it's good times in Louisiana for black males. It had been even harder back then for a black man to survive without holding one of the selected Negro jobs, farmhand, janitor, or the like. Now, even that right now. One, I know during certain periods, the language, very inaccurate and coarse, they would say man and mean everybody, males and females. So I don't know if this is that general black man means everybody, black males and black females, or if he specifically, and I think it even, there's a suspicion that might be what he means here, because certainly domestic work, that's not mentioned. I mean, black females, always domestic work and that sort of thing. So, and we talked about that before, how black females, it generally would be easier for them to get a job, even though you're not going to get any money either, domestic work, as I said, than black males. Matter of fact, Essie Mae Washington Williams get it 3 times. She talked about that over and over and over and over, regardless of where she was geographically, down and out, unemployed, no school, black males exclusively. Let's see, page 6. The old man's reputation dated back to the old days when he was a champion log roller, back when the trucks and bulldozers came, and bulldozers, back before trucks and bulldozers came into use, black families in rural areas had to help each other clear land on holidays or on Sundays when the traveling preacher wasn't in town. All the men within 10 or 20 miles would show up in the morning to clear somebody's land. Now, I mean, wow, that is counter-racist codification. I can't even imagine. I mean, wow. That right there, that's uses of time and energy. We're not getting together to do the boogaloo or anything else. Watch football, Thursday night football. Man, how about them Steelers? Woo! No. We're going to clear this land. You can put your house here, whatever it is. Get everybody within 10, 20 miles. We'll come. This is how we'll hang out and spend our weekend. And then go back about it. Like, wow. And didn't even have TikTok or text to help coordinate? Come on. Put us to shame in some sense, man. But I mean, hey, a lot less resources, no U-Haul, all the rest. They didn't even have power saws back then. So, I mean, woo, primitive times here. This is another one that feels like, woo, we are talking about like primitive time. And this is like, Neely Fuller Jr. was born, I believe, in 1929, unless my memory is bad. So, I mean, this is basically same generation. Primitive times. And they put us to shame in some sense. Not all, though. Let me keep reading. Nobody would burn all that, so they have to burn all the wood. The men would spend all day setting up this huge bonfire, leaving the trunks and big logs for last. And in the afternoon, the women and kids would arrive for a big barbecue while they were setting up the food. And the men would have their log rolling. Two men would have that. This is where, okay, this is sounding like we're getting to dominoes and all the rest. Like, are you serious? Law, and he didn't even get to it before you mash your finger, like, oh my god, like somebody is gonna get killed, have a foot rolled over. You got all kinds of primitive medicine back then and what have you. Like, Jesus Christ, like, no, like, we can do way more constructive things or call it a day. Like, we gotta eat, fine, we'll eat, listen to some music, talk about replacing white supremacy with justice, and then skedaddle, like, get out of here, maybe have some talk about preventing lynchings. And then, you know, out of here, log rolling and all the rest of it, especially continued if we got to get lit. Yeah. Let's see. And then, yeah, all of this about proving my strength. Look how strong you see that. Oh, it sounded so plantational. They said that's not in the word, God. So that's Gus T. It sounds, all of this sounds so plantational once they get away from the constructive part. Like, ooh, let me show you how many logs I can. It sounds like prison life, too. Like, ooh, let me get in here and bench press 800 pounds. And like, are you serious? We're out here in this rural country place hoping that we don't get lynched, man. Come on. That show-off-ism. Like, I am not here to impress any of you broke, down-and-out niggers in no-count Louisiana or anywhere else on the plantation. Try not to get lynched. Continuing. Let's see, page 9. I'd stayed at home for 3 or 4 hours a day while the women of our extended family fluttered around and worried. I grew steadily worse, and my family took me to the desperate step of driving me to the big hospital for white people. We've heard that so many times. And amazing that he talks about all these people in his family who lived such a long time with such, again, primitive medical techniques to begin with. And then you can't even go to the doctor. We read Dr. Maya Angelou. That's another one. Her autobiography. She talked about she couldn't even go to the dentist. She had to go to the veterinarian to get a tooth extracted. So he gets this sick, and then finally, okay, well, maybe the white people see you, maybe they don't. Put you in the, you know, custodian's closet or whatever. And then he's choked on cornbread. Wow. They said first 5 years, in addition to no corporal punishment, he's supposed to be breastfeeding exclusively for the first 5 years, so he wouldn't even have had that cornbread. Let's see, to choke on. Oh, and then he goes from the hospital for white people when it's really desperate. He goes to the Catholic hospital. We've heard about them all year long, and every time it's been raping children. Like, Jesus Christ, like, you got to be with him every second. Don't turn an eye. Don't leave him alone. He can't stay overnight. Like, oh, my God, you are in dangerous child rape territory. Whole state of Louisiana, for sure. Let's see. Page 10. He said, he's talking about his mother. She was rich, tender, strong all at once. If I had run into a king or queen, I would have been proud to show off my mother to them. I don't think Queen Elizabeth or King Charles would be impressed with a Louisiana Negro. Championships notwithstanding. Basketball playing Negro. Not impressed. Let's see. The situation when she talks, he's kind of shooting to the future briefly with this paragraph where they get to Oakland. He has this fight with the neighborhood children, and his mom makes him go and fight them both. I was curious if these were white children. It's hard for me to imagine this time period if some white children had done this, and particularly if they are growing up from Louisiana and lynchings and all that. If some white children had done this, would his mom have made him go fight these white children, given what could have happened? But that not with them. We didn't get those details. Let's see. Blame Taylor Branch for that. Let's see. He's talking about his grandfather, how he dated lots of females late up into his 70s and 80s. The showing off with sexual prowess, which is funny because at least the book that I have, I think they're different covers depending on which version of Second Wind you have. The cover that I have, it has he and his arch rival, Wilt Chamberlain, also a victim of racism on the cover. Wilt Chamberlain, in addition to being NBA Hall of Famer, one of the greatest of all time, is also in his autobiography, legendary. Talked about how he had sexual intercourse, I think, with like 10,000 females over the course of his career. So show, another form of show-offism, sexual exploits of the black male, walking phallus. Let's see. Page 16. All this where he's talking about his Aunt Cammy. She's the scandal of the King family because she dressed like a male. I thought, whoa, whoa, whoa. I thought, you know, black people were, you know, vicious homophobes. Like, he didn't talk about her being beaten up every day and smacked around and called names and all the rest. Like, she's at the dice game. She didn't like that. Get out of here. We're home. Get out of here. You don't even heard about. And these are black males that she's around. So, I mean, gee whiz, this is the bastion of the black male homophobe. She said that. Incidentally, she said that they tried to keep this secret from white people. I don't know why that would be. I mean, hey, this is Louisiana. We just talked Ronald Dominic. They're investigating the diocese in New Orleans right now. They got a long legacy. Half has never been told. We talked about this. So I don't know. And they don't have no secrets. They already know all this, I suspect. So anyway, but I didn't hear anything about Cammy being beat down. I guess people say, well, she couldn't be herself. She had to hide. Bill Russell said that his mom, parents wouldn't let her be in the house dressing like a man. I thought, again, black self-respect. Absolutely not. You are not going to be around here. We got young children, lots of young children. You're not going to be around here confusing them. great, your family. Again, I didn't hear any abuse, but you're not going to be coming in here confusing them about males and females. You don't have to make a word dress, I think, but you are not going to be coming in here dressing like a male. No way. Black self-respect. Black self-respect. Let's see. Page 18. The old people steered clear. Subjects like African slavery, talked about that. They talked about race was much more immediate. They talked about Huey Long. Many non-white people of this time period, particularly individuals classified as black in Louisiana, revered Huey Long. In fact, Black Panther Party co-founder, where did he get that name from? Many black people thought Huey Long, not a racist, cares about black people. Then he got assassinated. Oh, it's terrible. Or killed, however he died, whatever. But many black people had this sort of, I think many, many white people, we think of Jane Elliott, John F. Kennedy, Joe Biden, even for some. Let's see. Man, we just read, that's why I said the timing, beautiful. We read that Lane book, The Bayou Strangler, right in Louisiana. All these black, that's one of the reasons we read it. I didn't even know about this. Nearly 24 black males are killed in most of our lifetime, 2006, or starting in the 90s and going through the mid-2000s, early 2000s. I didn't know about this at all. No coverage, not talked about at all. Some things change, some things do not. Incidentally, he said black males. This is, again, another one where I don't think this is a general, because most of the people that were lynched by far were black males. This is another one where I don't think this is like black, when they say black man and they mean everybody. I think he means black males specifically. When they were killed, hey, they just disappeared. It wasn't talked about. It wasn't in the paper or what have you. In fact, let me get that whole thing. It said, usually the tale would be indirect form of discussion by some black man who disappeared. I think that's black male. That's not general. Someone might suggest that he could have run out on his wife. Of course, can't keep their pants up, Will Chamberlain. And someone might say that it was the Hinks. But then someone else might mention that the white people might have gotten him. Really? That's our last thought. After we get through the goblins, ghouls, no count, worthless nigga ran off with someone, maybe the white people got, like, woo, worthless Negroes. Most of the blacks who were lynched in those days, not killed in the way that made the papers, they simply disappeared. That is the exact book we just, in fact, let me get it, two times. That's the book we read two times, Absolute Madness and The Bayou Strangler. No one who'll be missed. How is that? How does that endure for, we're talking now covering a century. Bill Russell is talking about the 1930s. Joey 22 is in the 1980s and in New York, up north. And then Bayou Strangler, the 90s through the 2000s. How does that endure? Hops the century and everything. Y2K, doesn't matter. Any era, black males, no one who will be missed. The case for black females too, but wow, it does line up with Dr. Welsing's theory about what this is all about. Violence toward black males specifically, threat to white genetic annihilation, and Dr. Curry's analysis. Let's see. Page 19. Stories about such incidents were generally positive and hopeful. At least there had been no lynching in Monroe, which was more than could be said for the town of Ruston. There, a black man was accused of insulting a white woman and was strung up by a mob. The next day, his body was found still hanging. Ruston, it was agreed, was not as progressive. I don't even know what that word means. Progressive. Now, I think I got the one that we're talking about. I have to see how many lynchings they had in Ruston, but with the time period and everything, I'm pretty sure that this is it. There was a black man accused. Oh, and even there. Oh, I was two. That was two. One, counter violence. Now, the report that I read, I have to see how many lynchings that there were. If that's the same lynching that happened in Ruston, the report that I read, it didn't say that he insulted a white woman. It said that he took a baseball bat and clubbed a white man to death and then clubbed the white woman, too. That is not insulting. That goes, the indictment for this, it, for me, it doesn't go to Bill Russell. The indictment here goes to Taylor Branch, who is an award-winning historian. Bill Russell probably is telling this from memory, talking to relatives and blah, 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 and whatever else, and this is what happened, this is what they say, and he's pretty close to being accurate. Taylor Branch, you're a white man. You're an award-winning historian. You've been trained. You could have done the same thing that I did. Go and research. Who is this? One, the same thing. I got to keep saying this. Put a name on it. That's what they did in SMA Washington Williams. Zachariah Walker put a name on it. So that way it's definitive. We know exactly who this was. Readers can go do their research. Taylor Branch didn't do that. Worth nobody who will be missed. Can't even bother to give it. He could have put a footnote in on that. Come on, Taylor Branch. Let's see. When he says, he mentions this story. Oh, my God. Workplace racism. Jesus, Lord. This is why I told you I only read a little bit of this book, and I wanted to read it immediately. Creator said, oh, no. Just wait. Everybody will be talking about the Boston Celtics and a black male being reckless with his penis. And then you can read Bill Russell, Celtics legend, greatest Celtic of all time. Will fit much better. Of course. Of course. Had to be patient. So he gives this amazing anecdote that I might have to repeat for workplace racism. It fits for so many reasons. So this is his grandfather. They would talk about this story. His grandfather is at work, counter violence. He says his grandfather's at work. They've got this bad black male. Ooh-wee. He's tough, rough. Oh, wait a minute. So we got multiples. Can't get confused. That's why I said I was thinking because there's so many advanced examples of counter violence. So he fights off the Klan grandfather in 1917. Then he has the other story where he's got his mule or what have you, or he doesn't have it. They wants to give him the fodder. I'm going to make you do it. No, sir. Blah, blah, blah. All that. This ends up leading to the big shootout where he hides his family away. Amazing. He says Mr. Charlie told all this with great pride, talking about his dad and his grandfather's counter violence. He said his dad told this story with great pride. He had been only 5 years old at the time, and it was his earliest memory of his father. That is what racist man, racist woman do not want replicated. They understand the power of that. Yes, we're victims of white supremacy. They could have killed his father. They could have killed his whole family. They understand. His dad understood that. That's why they were scared. That's why he moved them. But Dr. Welsing talks about that all the time. Minister Malcolm X said that exactly before he was assassinated. Hey, I could be killed, and he was. But my children will remember I was trying to solve this problem. That is my cosmic assignment. That's the memory that I have of my father, of your grandfather, them standing up to a white man. In fact, standing up to a mob of white people. Whew. That's how you end up with Bill Russell. Greatest, arguably. People say, maybe it isn't Michael Jordan. Bill Russell has 11 championships. Michael Jordan has 6. That is a huge contributor. He didn't start this his book, his autobiography. He didn't talk about it. We haven't heard one word about basketball. Boston Celtics, nothing. He is talking about black people, all of, even his mother grabbed that gun. Sewer rat, bang, get out of here. Everybody. Black self-respect. You're not coming in here confusing my child, dressing like you don't know what gender you are. and we're not going to just let a black, oh, excuse me, a white person beat us down. Now, when he gets to his father, Mr. Charlie, workplace racism, he says that they got a bad black dude who would go, man, I remember this is straight out of Mr. Fuller's mouth. He said, that's what I said, Mr. Russell and Mr. Fuller are about same generation. Basically, Mr. Fuller's a couple, and I mean a couple years older, and that's it. Mr. Charlie had stories of his own. Once, not long after he got married, he was working for a construction company. They don't even allow niggers to work on construction companies. A grizzled, mean black dude who also worked there had the reputation for cutting up people with his knife on Saturday nights. Mr. Fuller asked, I think that's the third time he was on this program in 09, who you going to cut? Who's going to break bad at the nightclub? Because they didn't clarify who, what people. Who needs to get a knife in their guts at the nightclub? Black brother. That's why I said in some respects they put us to shame. In some respects, eh, same thing. So he continues. So he drove a 3-mule team for the company but had a habit of showing up late for work or not at all. Gusty says, hey, if you can't be early, be on time. That's timeless advice. He was late once too often for the white boss, who said one morning that apologies weren't good enough anymore, and who proceeded to slap and beat the tough guy in front of the other black employees. The tough dude didn't lift a hand, and when it was over, Mr. Charlie started laughing. Now pause right there. Whoa. Whoa. That, mister, we have talked about that all the time. You don't get to be tough. You don't show that you are the toughest, meanest, roughest, brutalizing all the niggers. That, what does that prove? That's nothing. Beat up everybody at the bottom of the slave ship. They already been conquered. You show out, okay, the real Mr. Charlie shows up. Break bad. Where's your knife? Here, I sharpened up your knife. Get to it. What, you just gonna let the white man? Mr. Charlie, talking about Mr. Russell's father, he sounded like Neely for like, what? I thought this Negro was tough. He smacked me around and everybody else smacked my cousin. You gonna let the white? You chumped out, man. You chumped me over that line. Now we continue. He says, what are you laughing at? Well, I thought that fellow was bad, laughed Mr. Charlie. I had heard about him cutting and whipping two or three people at a time. Again, what people? But he stood there and let you whip him. That don't make sense. And then, so then the white man says that, well, you know, I'm going to whip you. What is Mr. Russell? Mr. Russell's father was his response. No, Mr. George, I don't think so. If you do whip me, you'll be the best man, and I'll shake your hand afterwards. But I'm going to try my hand, and I don't think you can do it. Are you serious? Like, what in the world? That, in some respects, things are about the same. In other respects, wow. Whew. Black self-respect. Again, I submit that right there, that's how he started the book. That is a huge part. Bill Russell, greatest basketball player of all time, submitted by many, many basketball scholars. Gold medal, gaudy. Let's see. I think I got all of our notes in for the first portion. Did I get? Oh, wait a minute. I got the last one. So he's driving for the company. The mom does. Even that, you have to call her mom? Are you serious? Like, what? What? Okay, so he go, and we've been talking about that the whole way through the pandemic, so he has to drive for all of, I said, you have to have an extensive code. Can you imagine you work for a white person? They don't trust you. They measure out the gas by the teaspoon. But that's today, though. That's what I said. You're always under surveillance in a variety of forms. White people start shooting at him randomly on the road. That's Ahmaud Arbery. We still got that today. Some things change. Some things do not. Anywho, I will make sure that we got the correct Ruston lynching, or at least see if there are any other Ruston, Louisiana lynchings during this time period. But I think this is the correct one, and I'll make sure I post this report so folks can check it out. If you have other thoughts, observations, jot them down. We'll start our second audio segment, and that way we'll have lots of time for folks to share once it is done. This is the Katherine Massey Book Club at the Context of White Supremacy, the great Bill Russell's Second Wind, audio segment 2.
Mr. Charlie had a way of seeing the funny side of tense situations, and the tension wasn't always over white people. Once he was in an all-black juke joint, a place where minor vices were indulged and kids were not allowed. One guy put a nickel in the jukebox, and another one started patting his feet to the music. When the first one, mad as a wet hen, said, "Hey, nigger, don't be patting your foot on my nickel," a fight started. Mr. Charlie would describe how he turned over a table in the corner and crouched down behind it. When we asked him why he didn't join the fight and show everybody how strong he was, he'd laugh and say the dumbest thing a man could do was to let himself fight over something as stupid as another man's nickel. The only thing worse than not picking your own fights, he said, was to think you could serve some useful purpose or have some fun in another guy's fight. That wisdom must have sunk in. Years later, I'd always remember the juke joint fight as I watched countless scuffles among basketball players from my usual position on the bench, sitting there, resting alone, with a towel around my neck. Sound as it was, Mr. Charlie's strategy had to be modified on that particular night because the fistfight turned into a shooting match. When guns started going off, he bolted from behind his table, ran over a fat guy in the doorway, and made a long, flying leap to his truck. "I hit the running board, the starter, and the ignition all at once," he said. Mr. Charlie was proud of that old truck, but sometimes it got him into trouble when he drove around to jobs. In those days, it was unusual for a black man to own his own truck. One day, when he was driving through a town, a deputy sheriff pulled him over and began harassing him about driving too fast. "Boy, whose truck is this anyway?" demanded the deputy after he had yelled a while. "Mr. Charlie Russell's." "Well, you tell Mr. Charlie Russell to keep his nigger from driving through here so fast." "I sure will," said Mr. Charlie. "I'll tell him just as soon as I get home." We'd always laugh at that one. Mr. Charlie always seemed to find a way to laugh when he was the victim himself. But his temper would get loose when it was somebody else. That's what happened in two incidents that permanently changed the direction of our family. One Saturday afternoon, the day my mother went to town for groceries, she came home early, crying. I was about 7 at the time, and I couldn't stand it. The only other time I had seen her cry was at my grandmother's funeral. I couldn't imagine anything big or evil enough to make my mother cry, and her sobs shook my whole world. It was as if all my senses had been shut off so that I couldn't see or hear or anything, and the same big hurt that had grabbed her shook me so hard that I had to cry too. Mother said that one of the policemen in Monroe had grabbed her and cussed her for dressing like a white woman. He spoke real rough to her and told her he'd put her in jail if she didn't get out of town. She had been wearing an outfit more special to her than the one she wore on Sundays. It was a suit, modeled after the horse riding clothes popular among fancy white women, and she looked fancier in it than they did. Everything about it was just right, and she walked with an extra spring in that white blouse, with a pin at her throat in a trim suit coat and pants. Maybe the pants gave her a touch of Auntie Cammy's independent spirit. Mr. Charlie was there, but he didn't say anything. He just walked around mumbling to himself. I wanted to ask him what was wrong with my mother, but something told me not to say anything. The other incident happened not long afterward, on a Saturday afternoon in the first spring after Pearl Harbor. We were on our way home from an afternoon of visits and stopped to buy gas and a block of ice. The man at the station was pumping gas for a white guy, and when he finished, he stood there talking to the man about this and that and passing the time of day. Mr. Charlie was standing outside our car, and he kept waiting while the conversation rambled on, and my brother and I jumped up and down in the back seat, eager to get home. After about 10 minutes, I could tell that Mr. Charlie was starting to burn. But he didn't say anything. He was shifting his weight back and forth from one foot to the other. I'm sure the man who ran the station was letting him wait there on purpose, just to show that Mr. Charlie could do nothing about it. Then another white guy drove up, and the man waited on him quickly, pumped the gas, took his money, and waved goodbye. Then he just ambled back to the first customer and resumed his bull session. My brother and I became absolutely still because we could feel the anger in the air. Finally, Mr. Charlie couldn't take it anymore. He jumped back in our car and cranked it up off to drive off. Just then, the first customer left, and the station attendant looked mean at Mr. Charlie. He was standing in the door of his station, and just inside was a big rifle. He stormed over to our car and said, "Boy, don't you ever do what you just started to do." Then he cussed Mr. Charlie about his manners, spitting out the words, "I'd never heard anybody talk to my father like that," and my cheeks stung as if they had been slapped. The next thing I knew, Mr. Charlie walking toward that white man with a tire iron in his hand. The man got an empty look in his eyes as if he didn't believe what he was seeing, and his cussing petered out as Mr. Charlie walked slowly around the car toward him. He looked too frozen to go after his rifle. He just stood there until Mr. Charlie got within a step or two and then took off running, past the gas pumps and through the parking lot out onto the road. When he broke out running, Mr. Charlie let out a loud grunt and chased him up the road with that tire iron in his hand. Then I saw him stop and his whole back heaving with big, heavy breaths as he watched the man go. By then, my brother and I were about to burst with pride. We were so full of energy that we started punching each other lightly. And we would have cheered out loud, except that our mother had on a look that said not to. Still, when Mr. Charlie got back into the car, we couldn't resist chirping about how scared that man was and how funny he looked running off, until Mr. Charlie told us sharply to hush up. "There wasn't anything to be happy about," he said gruffly, which stunned and confused me. Mr. Charlie was so worried about what had happened that he took it right up with the old man, and they talked it over. "Do you think something's coming on behind this?" the old man asked. Mr. Charlie said no, but he was worried that something like it might happen again. It was many years before I understood why Mr. Charlie was so upset about something that I thought magnificent. "I didn't have hold of myself," he'd say. "I know deep down that I'd have hit that man with that iron if he hadn't run off. I'd have ended his life and ruined mine, plus my kids and my wife's. just because some fool was using me as a boy in front of my family. I let him take full possession of me, a grown man. I don't even like to think about it. Mr. Charlie related this incident to one of his sayings. When you come across a fool who can't help himself, he'd say, always remember that he's a fool. Don't bother with him. On up the road, he's liable to run into another fool, and one of them will destroy the other. I took all this in, but it never erased the nice feeling I still got from the memory of that guy hightailing it out of the station. Not long after that, Mr. Charlie broke the news that we were going to move out of Monroe. We were pulling up stakes and maybe we'd become like those families who return every summer to visit from the north, driving long cars, wearing shiny clothes, and making people uncomfortable. The whole idea of moving was a shock to my brother and me. We weren't well traveled. New York, Chicago, and Los Angeles were huge fairylands to us, even bigger than New Orleans, somewhere over the Louisiana line. Even then, my young instincts told me that our leaving had something to do with the policeman who'd yell at my mother and the gas station attendant. And I was puzzled. I couldn't understand why we had to leave because a white man had gotten scared of Mr. Charlie. It didn't make sense. But then nothing about the world of white people made much sense to me. I'd scarcely had contact with any. There were none in my school, of course, and the white kids I did see usually threw rocks at my friends and me when we walked into town. On lucky days, they just called one of us a few names. As for white neighbors, there was only one white family that lived anywhere near us, and they were strange. The husband kept to himself and screamed all through the night, such long, horrible screams that everybody talked about how the haints must have gotten him. My mother told me that the man was shell-shocked from World War I, but that didn't explain it to me. I didn't know what shell-shocked meant. Then there were white strangers, people we'd meet in stores and gas stations. They could be rude to my parents and then pat me on the head without a second thought. It all added up to a mystery, which was one reason I listened to the stories the grown-ups told at the family gatherings. One steady theme was the nature of white people, and I was still looking for the answers. No one else seemed to wonder as much as I did why we were leaving. Mr. Charlie was busy huddling with the men he knew, talking about places up north. Soon there was a big send-off for him when he went off by himself on the train to find us a new home in Detroit. Weeks went by. Finally, we got a letter saying that he'd found a job at the Ford Motor Plant making war machinery, followed by another letter saying he'd gotten so sick from riding the bus to work in the cold that the doctors said he'd die if he stayed in Detroit. Mr. Charlie didn't like the cold anyway, so he took off straight for California. One day he sent for us. He was ready for us to move. The hardest goodbye for me was the one I said to a girl. Her nickname was Too Little, which she'd gotten stuck with because she was always saying she wasn't too little to do this or that. She was 9, like me, black as charcoal, and so cute that I wanted to squeal with delight whenever I saw her, though I'd have died before letting anybody know that. I promised Too Little that I'd come back for her just as soon as the family returned home to visit Grandpa Russell. I sat next to my mother in the colored section of the train all the way to St. Louis, and then for the first time in our lives, we could sit anywhere. At first, the old man did not approve of our migration. He said he was too old and set in his ways even to think of moving himself. I think he doubted Mr. Charlie's prospects outside Louisiana, and he hated to see him go. But in the end, he came to believe that it was for the best. He and Mr. Charlie would talk it over between them. One thing was for sure, they'd say. Moving would help my brother and me get a better education. All three of my family idols were devoted to the idea of school, Education was a great shining stepladder for Black families in those days. Though you couldn't point to many who had climbed on it a long way, still it was the brightest hope we had as long as there was only one Joe Louis. The old man who couldn't read or write was always singing the praises of education. To him, being educated meant being able to think for yourself, and he joked that he never needed schooling to do that. Then he would turn serious and say that he'd gone as far in school as he could for a boy who grew up in the old days with no father. And he'd tell in great detail how he had worked to push Mr. Charlie through school. It had been a hard road for Mr. Charlie. During the national outbreak of meanness that followed World War I, one seems to follow all wars, some of the local diehards burned the Black schoolhouse to the ground just as he started to go there. Citing a temporary shortage of funds, a county government announced that the schoolhouse could not be rebuilt right away. Furthermore, since there was no colored schoolhouse, there seemed to be no sense in paying teachers any more than 3 months a year. This situation lasted all the way through Mr. Charlie's grammar school years, so he went to school in a church. A bunch of the local Black parents risked reprisal from the diehard whites and hired their own teacher at the rate of $1 a month per head. The old man was the ringleader of the group that hired a teacher, and he used to say that Mr. Charlie had gotten $1 a month education. My father would talk about getting whipped in that church and about what a joy it had been to show off his reading for the old man. When he was in a dark mood, he'd talk about how the white kids would ride by in their school bus and throw tomatoes and rotten eggs at the Black kids on foot. 50 years later, when the country got all stirred up about busing, Mr. Charlie would joke that he always thought busing was only for white kids. The old man had one simple rule for Mr. Charlie about school. He could drop out at any time he wanted. But when he did, he couldn't live under his father's roof. It was stay in school or leave home. And the old man laid down this law with his usual economy of words. We always heard that Mr. Charlie advanced as far as the Negro could go in his time, just like his father in those old days. What both of them kept secret from me until long after I was grown and had kids of my own was that this rule had once torn them apart. It was in 1927, the year Babe Ruth had such a great season up in New York. It wasn't such a good year for Mr. Charlie. He was 15 years old and tired of walking 8 miles every day to Monroe Colored High School. By the hard practical reasoning he'd learned from the old man himself, it didn't make sense to him. That summer, he'd gotten a job driving a tractor for 30 cents an hour, which worked out to about $60 a month. At the time, Black teachers were paid only $30 a month when they were working, and they held down about the only jobs for educated Negroes. A preacher's, doctors, and morticians were allowed to treat their own kind, but these jobs didn't appeal to Mr. Charlie. And for all practical purposes, it seemed that he was going to school in order to become a school teacher. As the summer drew to an end, it chafed him to think about giving up his tractor job and all the money it paid just so he could go back to school and qualify to be like the parents of some of the kids he knew, who in their prime were earning about half what he was already making as a 15-year-old boy. Besides, he liked running that big tractor outdoors better. A lot better. Then he liked sitting in that classroom with a bunch of prissy girls who put on airs. He pointed all this out to his father with more and more urgency, finally begging to be allowed to drop school. But the old man would not budge. They butted heads, and Mr. Charlie said that on many evenings, the angry words from supper would still be bouncing off the walls late at night. So one night, Mr. Charlie ran away like a hobo, jumping on a train as it went by. All he had with him was his anger, plus all the food he could carry. and about half his wits, since he was all torn up inside about leaving everything and everyone he'd ever known. All night he prayed for guidance, but by the next morning, he found he'd already made a horrible mistake. Instead of catching the train north towards St. Louis, as planned, he'd gone east to Vicksburg across the Big River and was headed through Mississippi. It took him 3 months to get out of that state. He had bad luck with the trains, partly because the railroad men were more vigilant, and he had worse luck with the jobs they were supposed to be giving out on the flood levees. After many missed meals and nights out under the stars, his tired feet finally brought him back home to Monroe like the prodigal son. The old man said he was too glad to see him to whip him. Many black people ran away from Mississippi in the 20s, some fleeing for their lives, but my father must have been one of the few who ever ran away to Mississippi. Mr. Charlie didn't tell me about this disaster because he didn't want to undermine his own rule about staying in school, which was identical to the old man's. The only person more zealous about education than Mr. Charlie was my mother. She gave me the middle name Felton, after Felton Clark, who was then president of Southern University. And she inspired Mr. Charlie to take out two $2,500 insurance policies that would mature into college funds for my brother and me. He started making payments on July 8, 1935. When I was a year old, and he always kept them up. She also agreed with Mr. Charlie to limit the size of our family, which was rare in those days. They did this so that their kids would have a better chance of being educated. We didn't want a house full of half-hungry children, Mr. Charlie would say later when we asked him why we didn't have more brothers and sisters. You can't run hungry. You can't learn nothing hungry. You can't even think good hungry. I went through the first three grades of school in a one-room Louisiana building that was so dilapidated they had to prop up the structure with poles in the winter when the wind blew. Oakland was a different world. We had real desks and teachers for each grade and all kinds of studies and activities that so excited my mother that she'd make me tell her everything when I came home every day. She'd go through lessons with me and answer my questions and stand up for me whenever I needed it. That warm feeling survived the long jump to California. Every morning I felt I was going out to slay a big dragon for her, and I'd come home from school to tell her how it hadn't stood a chance, just like we'd figured. School was just beginning in the fall of 1946 when I came home one day to find that my mother had gone into the hospital. It was flu, they said, nothing serious. For the first 2 weeks, whenever we went to visit her, she'd laugh and talk about how she had the doctors all confused. After one of those visits, Mr. Charlie woke us out of a sound sleep a few hours later and said, "Your mother died tonight." The doctors said it was unexpected, but they didn't even know what that word meant as far as I was concerned. I was 12. Mother was 32, and she was gone. The next thing I knew, we were on a train back to Louisiana with the casket in the baggage car just ahead of us. I was in a daze. I remember being cheerful for long stretches of the trip because I was so sure that Mother would come back. For months, I'd have dreams of her rocking me awake in the morning, or of her walking into my classroom at school, or appearing out of the tall grass back in Monroe, always hugging me and laughing at the idea that she'd ever leave me. On the train, these visions were much more real than the clacking of the tracks or the eerie silence that enveloped Mr. Charlie. Every few hours, he'd lead us up to the baggage car. We'd just stand there near the casket for a minute or two and then return to our seats. All I remember about the funeral was that when they asked me if I wanted to look at my mother's face, I refused. After all the crying, it was not long before I realized that my future was being discussed in the family councils. Our Louisiana relatives thought Mr. Charlie could never raise two young boys by himself out there in California, and they wanted him to move back to Monroe, where he had kinfolk to pitch in and help. When he refused, it was assumed that he'd go back to Oakland alone and leave Charlie and me there to be parceled out among our aunties, or at least among the four married ones, other than the footloose Auntie Cammy. She didn't take part in the discussions, and neither did her father, who had whistled into town for the funeral of his daughter, and then whistled on out again before life returned to normal. I would never see him again. By tradition, Mr. Charlie could leave us kids there in Louisiana with absolute assurance that we would be raised, even if no one ever heard from him again. He could send for us at any time, when he remarried, for instance, or he might never send for us. The extended family would always be there, like a safety net beneath all the children stranded by the hardships of the great Black migration out of the South. Over many generations, all the way back to slavery, Black families had developed customs for the sheltering and releasing of stray children. There seemed to be intricate rules about which relative would take what child under every circumstance. The taking in was to be done in the closest possible imitation of a natural family, and the giving up was to be done quickly with stoic smiles and a chorus of farewells that was all for the best. Years later, sitting in a nightclub somewhere in New York, I was startled at comedian Lenny Bruce's knowledge of Black families. Over the course of several evenings, he pumped me to find out such things as what it feels like to know that your cousin or aunt can suddenly be transformed into your mother. Bruce admired Black families. He thought it would be nice to know that you could go off and get your ass kicked by the world for 20 years, then come back to your kinfolk and be taken in. At the same time, he seemed to understand my point that the family would be supporting you only at periods when you were so low that you probably wouldn't appreciate it. "Yeah, but it's still a refuge," he'd say in his harsh accent. Like all the comedians I've known, he seemed serious to the point of being morose when off stage. He'd remark sarcastically that this main family experience had been with the big family, the Catholic Church, which had enormous political power in all the cities where Bruce performed, and which in his mind was responsible for most of the legal harassment he suffered. Back then, of course, Lenny Bruce was worlds away from me. At the time, while the adults huddled with each other over my future, I occupied myself by going to see my old friends. This brought another blow. My girlfriend, Too Little, had died the year before at the age of 11. It wasn't a romantic loss. I had been stewing over what to tell her about the city girls in Oakland. But it shook me that someone my own age could also die. The first thing that brought me out of my numbness was Mr. Charlie's announcement that he was taking us back to Oakland with him. No matter what the family said, he told everybody that we could make it ourselves, but that seemed doubtful. Our send-off was very emotional. The sadness of the funeral was still heavy, and mingled with the sadness, love, and admiration for Mr. Charlie as the family's stubborn ambassador to the outside world, I sensed some disapproval.
Context of White Supremacy, Katherine Massey Book Club. That will wrap up our first installment, Bill Russell, Second Wind, featuring Taylor Ranch, suspected racist, still in Chapter 1. If you have commentary to share, the number is 720-716-7300, the code 564-943, pound, press star 61 if you would like to participate, the email untiljustice@gmail.com. Do not wait until the last moment if you have commentary to share. I did check while we were hearing the second installment. I did not find another lynching during the time period that we were looking for. I did see, obviously, other lynchings in Louisiana, but for Ruston specifically at the time period, I think R.C. Williams, that is the lynching that is being referred to in the book, so I will stand by what I said. Taylor Branch, that is number one. I don't fault Bill Russell for that. Taylor Branch, you are the expert. That's why they put you on this book. Why didn't you do the digging to include R.C.? Put a name on it. Give some detail. Let us see. Folks who dialed, I'll get the phone first, then we'll get the emails. People who dialed in via the phone line, if you have commentary on the second portion of the reading, anything that stood out. Let's see, victim in New Jersey, retired firefighter in Florida. If you all have commentary, proceed.
Yes, sir. I have a few things that I'm going to quickly go through. Continuous lessons from mom and dad. It really informs me about the person that I know, that I have, I didn't know him personally, but that I have studied about by the name of Bill Russell, you know, with the advent of all of these lessons that he is recording about his parents. Matter of fact, you so far, almost every paragraph that you read, that the lady reads, it has his father's nickname. You know, it starts off with his father's nickname, Mr. Charlie, Mr. Charlie, Mr. Charlie, all through the thing. So, and that tells you about the person himself, William Russell, the tragic death of his mom. That I can almost feel that, you know, with the advent of a child, 13 years old. And with the type of relationship that he had with his mom, and all of a sudden that takes place. And it also gives an indication of how terrible health care was, especially during that time. Not saying that it's perfect now, but it certainly was very terrible, especially for black people. It was even bad for white people, but especially terrible for black people, especially during that time. The advent of saving for college is like, you know, wow, black self-respect. I think I heard that during this recent reading, where the parent or parents were already thinking about their children when it came to education. And that also tells you something about William Russell. And how that affected him constructively. The advent of counter violence, Louisiana black males have been known through history with that. You had the Black Panther Party, where most of the members of the Central Committee, I believe it was called. The main body of the Black Panther Party were actually black males from the state of Louisiana. And then you're talking about the Deacons for Defense. That was an organization that functioned around in the state of Louisiana, Bogalusa, Louisiana. I believe I'm pronouncing it right. I don't know for sure. Also here, I've read that. Dad taking on the responsibility of continuing the responsibility of raising his children. It also tells you something about the person that this book is focusing about. All of those things are very vitally important that black males especially attempt to be fathers, be dads. My 25-year-old, just 26-year-old, just left out of this house today, and you know, you always think about. I never worried about another person so much until I had a child, a quote unquote child of my own, you know. And so those are just some of the things that I thought was important in the second reading. Thank you.
Much obliged, retired firefighter in Florida. Let's see, our victim.
Yeah, Gus.
Yes, sir.
Yes. Okay. Some things. Black culture. I know right now, with people have their eyes to Twitter and social media, which is a very toxic place. Black Americans are arguing that, yes, indeed, we do have culture, and really full of that culture is, if I'm not mistaken, is basically like, you know, what you're doing like right now. So when he described the black family taking in children, and, you know, when other families deaf or just any, you know, anything that that basically prohibited a particular adult to take care of their child, I'm familiar with that. I also think that that black culture and that Southern tradition is what got most black families through the 1980s crack era, where the same grandparents, grandfather, grandmother that Bill Russell is describing took on the responsibility of taking away throwaway children. Black male self-respect is always taught that black males cut and run. Mr. Charlie made a decision to keep his children together. Today we are talking about the irresponsible spending of black people and the wealth gap. And the wealth gap sometimes get placed on black people, how irresponsible we are with money, or we don't save, or we spend money on Jordans. Mr. Charlie not only understood that I'm not going to add on any more children to this family. You know, because he understood the cost. So they made a conscious decision to cap the size of the family, black self-respect. Just basically the importance of education. So again, these tropes that we get, kind of like we repeat that white people put on us, which isn't true. Black people, and I think many cases, always stress the importance of education. Even when we talk about the wealth gap, just the fact that Mr. Charlie was thinking about his children's future, you know, so these wasn't throwaway children. This wasn't the drunken father who just left, and you know what I mean? You know, you hear about, you know, all these absentee fathers. And when these fathers were absent, there was a lot of reasons why. Some had to escape white terrorism. Mr. Charlie was aware of that. Mr. Charlie knew the consequences of when he lost his school and picked up the tire iron and, you know, possibly would have basically hit the gas attendant, you know. So not only so he is just basically the poster child for a Negro that was supposed to be lynched. Again, the importance of school. You know, the fact that education, you know, was pushed, but Mr. Charlie also understood that his education during that time wasn't going to get him so far. To use a metaphor, he would have ended up in dead-end jobs or jobs that were selected for black people. Fighting over a nickel. Fighting over a nickel. Francis Crutch Wilson told black people to stop squabbling. Mr. Charlie practiced, again, black self-respect. Now, one time has Mr. Charlie, in this writing, has kind of like really practiced any violence or hostility towards a black person. You know what I mean? Everything was just counter-racist. All his encounters were with white people. And the violence that we see, then when we talk about putting things into context, like Mr. Charlie talked about in the juke joint, not only do black people, or do white people place less value on black people also in an environment of anti-blackness, they adopt the same behavior. That's why the black male that was cutting everybody up knew when he went up against white people, he had to stand down. You know what I'm saying? So we have adopted that. You know, black people, white people don't think black people are worse anything, and black people has also inherited that view of black people, which this is why we see over-exaggerated violence in the black community. Again, Gus, I'm enjoying this book, and also I apologize. I unmuted my phone by mistake. Can't wait for next week to listen to further reading.
Oh, well, much obliged, sir. I told you all I wanted to read it immediately. Mr. Udoka, Ime Udoka, head coach of the Boston Celtics, at least for now. Man, all that attention on the franchise, man, oh, man. Hopefully some folks will be paying attention. We'll be chatting it up about the Celtics. We haven't even gotten to the Celtics. We haven't even really got to California rooted yet. Man, I can tell you right now, when we come back next week, we will hear from Mr. Russell himself. We will not be Shaq and all these other folks. Let's get Mr. Russell on and have him tell you about that situation with his mother and that dress. Let's get his telling of it and see if it matters, because this will be the third time. So we'll hear him tell it directly. We'll hear the book with a white co-author, Taylor Branch. And then we already heard this story with his mother in the dress in Isabel Wilkerson's The Warmth of Other Suns. Do the written versions match what Mr. Russell says about this incident? And if not, what's been changed? That's our teaser for next week. Very beginning. Call her at 5698. Did you have commentary? Call her at 5698, last four digits, or are you just listening?
Yes, sir. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yes. My name is Brother R.C., calling from Miami, Florida. I enjoyed this first installment, reading, of, the life of, Bill Russell. And it's very engaging, the reading itself and the commentary from you and your callers. Never liked the Celtics. I started watching basketball in the mid-60s. At a time where in our village, we only had one or two TVs, black and white, grainy. We'd all gather around to watch Bill Russell versus Wilt Chamberlain. Wilt Chamberlain was my guy. Bill Russell was not my guy. And the Celtics were something less than to be desired as far as I was concerned then. And up until now, I kind of leaned toward the Celtics when KG and Ray Allen and crew won their championship there. But the Celtics themselves were not less than favorable for me. However, as I matured and learned of this individual, Bill Russell, his commitment to justice, his willingness to stand and speak, to take agency in his belief in justice. Just like my appreciation for Martin Luther King grew, my appreciation for this brother grew. And hearing his story, I can see why. I can see where he got his perspective from. And basically, that's what I want to say here. Didn't want to say much, but just want to let you know how much I enjoyed this first installment. To me, Bill Russell is really every man, from the standpoint that his story is the story of a people. We have a little saying among my friends. We say, so goes a person, so goes the people. And in this case, I think it applies. Bill Russell's story is the story of a people. Displacement, suffering from violence and injustice in the South. A people virtually run off their land, run out of their home. At the same time, a people who endured, who held on to something in spite of the conditions. And the reason why I say this is because he's, you know, the stories that he's telling is the stories of my people, in my family. I can remember the elders always bragging about standing up to the white man, about individuals in our family who took a stand on this, this store, on that road, with that whatever. My father just died this year. In March of this year, my father passed. He was 98 years old, which, you know, his life was virtually the life of the 20th century. And I knew my grandfather. I was 21 years. I'm 73 this year. I was 21 years old when my grandfather died. He was born in 1873. And my uncles, all of these men and women, but particularly the men, since I'm a male, would tell these stories, stories on the end of various encounters, of various situations where they had to endure and overcome and maintain their pride in spite of the situation. So here this brother, Bill Russell, is distilled from these collective experiences and become one of the greatest athletes on record of all sports. And to do so up until the very end with a smile and with a certain grace. And that's our people. That's us as a people. In spite of all that we've gone through, we're still here and we're still smiling. We're still gracious in life. We still have this sense of justice. We're still balanced in our approach to human beings for the most part. In fact, I see a more devaluation in recent times than I have ever before. One would argue that that's not the case, but I lament often about how people are devolving to something that's strange even to me in the public domain and then on these message platforms, whatnot. Anyway, I'm just grateful that in spite of how great this brother was, that I find some commonality with him. I am the first generation
30 seconds
of my people out, yes, sir, out of the woods. My people before me, all of my people were still in the backwoods of Georgia. I'm the first generation out of the woods. And so this story that this brother is telling really touches my heart. Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you so much, sir, for dialing in. Our caller who wrote in, I'm going to finish up his commentary right now before we wrap up, but he said the same thing that you did, that this, you know, sounds so much like what he's experienced. I think even retired firefighter had some, hey, this is very close to where I went to school at. Grambling isn't that far. Yeah. Anywho, much obliged, sir, for dialing in. All that commentary about the Celtics, man, stay tuned. We haven't even got that far yet. My goodness. Stay tuned. Anywho, I said our listener who wrote in, I didn't finish his commentary. Picking up on number 10, he writes from page 22, the mom, so this is when his granddad worked for the white people. They measured the gas and all. The mom really mistrusted people, especially blacks, measured out the gas for each trip with a measuring cup. To dominate a group of people requires precision and dedication. The science of the global system of racism, white supremacy. Number 11, page 28, a hard road for Mr. Charlie, national outbreak of meanness that followed World War I. Describing it as meanness doesn't seem to accurately capture the white terrorism perpetuated on black people after World War I. Fantastic point. And again, that I blame Taylor Branch, the white co-author of this book. I'm sure he could have picked a better word. And he's a historian, so he knows. Anybody who's confused, you can get Red Summer. I think that's... Oh, I forget. His name will come to me in a second. But Red Summer, he was a guest on the program, white author, in the autumn, about this time of 2011. He writes for the Wall Street Journal. Anywho, number 12, page 27, white kids threw rocks at my friends. Lucky days, just call a few names. They would just call us a few names. Page 28 to 29, the old man. White kids would ride by in the school bus and throw tomatoes and rotten eggs. Thought busing was only for white kids. We've read similar stories. White children, for example, at Sundown Towns by James Lowen, Racist Man, Racist Woman, and Let Us Not Forget Racist Child, and way back when we read The Little Rock Nine. That was Signature Cow's work. Elizabeth and Hazel. There's a lot of white children terrorizing. Melba Petilla Beals. I told you we had the autobiography kings. But many examples of white children terrorizing. Page 13. Page 30, excuse me. Middle name, Felton Clark, president of Southern University. His father, Joseph Samuel Clark, preceded him as president of Southern University. At the time of Felton's retirement in 1969, Southern University had the largest enrollment of any HBCU at 11,000, probably not even funded correctly. Number 14, page 30, limit the size of our family, which was rare in those days, reminds me of what Dr. Welsing recommended, no more than two children, at least 4 years apart for black people. I thought it was 2 years apart, but yeah. Number 15, page 32, comedian Lenny Bruce's knowledge of black families, controversial white comedian known for challenging obscenity standards of the time. Should we be surprised that he knew about black families? Perhaps not. I'm sure he's been to New Orleans, brothel or two. White people are not ignorant about racism. Taylor Branch either. He's an expert. Let's see. All right, let me get my notes. We'll wrap up our first session. Like I said, I was so excited to read this book for so many reasons. He starts off this session. So we had the bad Negro, right, who got his razor and cut up everybody at the juke joint. And then the white man smacks him around on the job and he doesn't sneeze or lift a finger. We start audio segment two. Mr. Charlie, they're at the juke joint, all black, so you already know. One guy put a nickel in the jukebox and another started patting his foot on the music when the first one, mad as a wet hen, said, "Hey, nigga, don't be patting your foot on my nickel." And Mr. Fuller, who you gonna cut at the juke joint, man? Who's gonna break bad? Who's gonna pat their foot to your song? I said, some things have changed. Some things have not. Now, you go to the club today, the same thing is liable to happen 100 years later. You looking at me? You stepped on my... So, the club, terrible place to be. Always has been. Always. That's what... This is the sort of thing where I look when black people, older black people, some of them, when they get on their high horse, these young black people, and just got their pants hanging down. Hey. You maybe didn't have your pants hanging down. That wasn't the style then, but don't you be acting like the behavior is that different from what you all were doing. Victims 50, 60, 100 years ago, our behavior patterns have unfortunately been very enduringly pitiful. Trying to change that. Let's see. Oh, I love it. They assumed it's not his truck. And so he says, oh, it's Mr. Charlie's truck. When the policeman stopped, he says, well, you tell Mr. Charlie not have his nigger running around all fast. Oh, yes, sir. I'll tell him. Like, love it. Love it. And just saying, sir, sometimes, wow, can get you out of trouble even when you are still being defiant. Love it. Love it. Love it. Let's see. This whole section where he talks about white people, Neely Fuller Jr. This is why it's white guests only on the cows. Neely Fuller says white people are the most familiar mystery. By the way, Ruston, Louisiana, I suspect it probably was not a sundown town. Again, James Lowen said most of the sundown towns were in the north, not the south. Ruston, Louisiana, according to U.S. Census records, is a majority black town. So if it was at some point, it has gone and undergone a radical transformation to now be a majority black town, according to the U.S. Census. That notwithstanding, Mr. Russell's passage talking about white people, and particularly when you put that, when I say racism, white people, that's the same thing. What does it mean to be white? Racism, race, that's the same thing. The only reason to belong to a race is to practice racism. The only race is the white race. He said they didn't talk about racism. When he gets to white people, he says, even then, my young instincts told me that our leaving had something to do with the policeman who yelled at my mother. Ooh, we're going to have to start. That's where we start at next week. We get Bill Russell giving the verbal presentation of this story to the co-author, Taylor Branch. It is not the same as what's written in this book. It is substantially different. Yelled at my mother and the gas station attendant, and I was puzzled. I couldn't understand why we had to leave because a white man had gotten scared of Mr. Charlie. It didn't make sense, but then nothing about the world of white people made much sense to me. I scarcely had contact with any. There were none in my school, of course. And the white kids I did see usually threw rocks at my friends and me when we walked into town. On lucky days, they just call us a few names, which even that. As for the white neighbors, there was only one white family, and they lived anywhere near us, and they were strange. The husband kept to himself and screamed all through the night, so all of the white people who didn't have mental health problems didn't live near the Negros in Louisiana. My mother told me that the man was shell-shocked from World War I, but that didn't explain it to me. I didn't know what shell-shocked meant. Then there were white strangers, people we'd meet in the stores and gas stations. They could be rude to my parents and then pat me on the head without a second thought. Cute little negro until he turns about 10. Then he's a raping negro. It all added up to a mystery, which was one reason I listened to the stories the grown-ups told at family gatherings about Haints. He doesn't say Haints there, but that's what we heard. One steady theme was the nature of white people, and I was still looking for the answers. Wow. He He could have written that today, 5 minutes ago, and it would be true all over the world. We are still looking for the answers. What the most familiar mystery? What does it mean to be white? Wow. People didn't even pick out that passage except for the children part. Let's see. All this about education is extraordinary. But if you don't understand racism, white supremacy, I also mark this passage when he gets to education. He says, education was a great shining stepladder for black families in those days, though you couldn't point to many who climbed on it a long way. Uh-oh. Still, it was the brightest hope we had as long as there was only one Joe Lewis, illiterate tax cheat Joe Lewis, who has been mentioned so many times. The Cows Book Club, I already met us two times. Dr. Maya Angelou mentions him in her book. I think he came up in so many times. I would hurt my head even thinking about. I think he came up in Essie May. Came up there too, like so many times. He's come up in the book club and the program in general. Again, illiterate tax cheat victim of white supremacy. Detroit. Let's see. That is, though, one reason why you want to get all the education that you can so that you are not illiterate. Study white people. Let's see. My father would talk about getting whipped at the church and about what a joy it had been to show off his reading for the old man. When in a dark mood, that word again, he'd talk about how the white kids would ride by in the school bus and throw tomatoes and rotten eggs again, white children. I think he's even going to talk about Little Rock in this book. How could he not? He would have watched that from Boston. Oh, my God. Wait, I think he teased that. Save that for next week. Let's see. Train to St. Louis. Pause for Mike Brown. Vic Curran crossed the river, headed to Mississippi. Took him 3 months. Again, like I said, this is like caveman times. Can you imagine 3 months just to get from Mississippi? The state is next door. It didn't even take that long during the worst days of Hurricane Katrina. 3 months? Are you serious? It sounded like he had to walk. Like, what in the world? Total caveman times. Let's see. All of this about the insurance policies. This sounds much closer to, hey, let's be serious about having children. We're not going to have them close together, Dr. Welsing. We're not going to have 50,000 children. We're going to have a specific number so that we do not have more children when we have time and resources to take care of and provide a high quality of life as much as we can, given, you know. That sounds much. We're going to put aside money for the education. We have a plan for all of this well in advance. Not thinking of all this way down the road and, well, maybe we should have only had 2 children and not 10. Like all of that goofing. Like, this sounds much closer to the way it should be. Like I said, in some respects, like, wow, they're making us look really bad 100 years ago in caveman times. Then other respects, yeah, it's about the same. Let's see. His mom excited about education once they get to California. She wants to learn as much as he does. Like, that is amazing. Again, having all that support from mom. Again, when he talks about Lenny Bruce, who already brought, he is an expert on black people, and he talks about his connection to the big family. I don't know if he was molested. In fact, I have to check to see. Did he make any allegations about his time with the Catholic Church? We'll see. Don't know if he grew up Catholic. I know he had problems with them, with his obscene performances on stage and such. Is that on my notes? Did I get everything? Great, because we did a little bit over. Let's see. Yeah, I will submit, number one, when they talk about this family network, man, Dorothy Roberts killing the black body and Shattered Bonds. Those are two different books. She was a guest on the program in 2009 and again in 2010, again in 2011. But for those first two books, I vehemently submit white supremacist foster care gets way more black children than the network and all that. Yes, that's super important and has done a lot, but I mean, hey, I said the biography champs. We did read Minister Malcolm's autobiography. He didn't say that the Black Family Network scooped up him and his relatives, unless my memory is really bad. That's not what he said. That's not the record of what happened. Let's not mess around with black culture and call things as they are. The most familiar mystery, you grab a book and figure it out. Killing the Black Body, Shattered Bonds. I submit they trump anything you want to talk about with our ragtag aunt, uncle, and all the rest of it. Don't let me get started on Antoine Fisher either. Let's see. Oh, and the Haints, Right Together. Oh my God. Follow logic. They said the order was a black male disappears. Oh, I bet he running around on his wife, which there's a lot of that for sure. But that was one. Then it was the Haints. Oh my God. When you get people, and I mean, hey, white people do have a lot of Haint nonsense, mumbo jumbo in white supremacy culture, bewitched. They have flipping Groundhog Day. Matter of fact, take what's right in front of you. Aren't we getting ready for frickin' goblins and hobgoblins and woo, all that? So, I mean, hey, they have a whole lot of that in white culture and promote that, like, right now. That's it. When you have people that are illiterate and they can't go to school, and I was correct, by the way, I could put my follow-through on that one, too. Tuskegee syphilis experiment was started by the time they were chatting about all this in the mid-1930s. But when you have black people totally confounded, you don't allow them to go to school. He's already seen this. Like, if you do get education, you're not going to be allowed to do anything with it anyway. That's how you can end up with people where all they're really allowed to do is church, work in the fields, be terrorized. And then you're coming around with white sheets and everything else and guns and keeping them afraid. And then white Jesus. Where, yeah, you do have people who are just into a lot of nonsense. If anybody here believes in Haints or what have you, follow logic. That is what they want. When you can't explain things, you don't have logic to explain cause and effect and why things happen. Haints, are you serious? That is a subject, people. When you have individuals who do not have logic, they have Haints. And even the people who say that they don't believe in so-called Haints will sit around and talk about Haint activity for hours on end. That is a conquered people. That is what happens when you have people can't go to the library, don't learn, don't read, can't use my brain. Come, he said, nobody can. You got a whole group of people that are illiterate. That's what happens. Hocus pocus and voodoo and mumbo jumbo and all the rest of logic. That's why I see the value of, nope, you are going to school. We are not going to have another generation of Haints. Education, learn as much as you can. You do not want to be Joe Lewis. Illiterate, tax cheat, heavyweight champion. Mr. Fuller quote, he said, they go to Joe Lewis, he won the title. Joe, what do you say? Tell Ma, I win. That's white people are to blame for that too. Same thing I said with Taylor Branch. White people are to blame for all of that. Joe Lewis being illiterate and what the caller said, this is our story. Generations of black people being illiterate and functionally illiterate. That's white people are to blame. All of that. Try to correct that. Learn as much as still learning. Excited, eager about learning. Learn as much as we can. Read as much as we can. not about what you, that television is real close to Hank sitting around and talking about Real Housewives and Netflix, and that is real close to Hank's. Wrap there and be back for Bill. Right, we didn't even get to the Celtics part. Like, my God, when we get to Boston, ain't no talk about Hanks. Now we just get to real life. What does it mean to be white? But we didn't get there yet. Matter of fact, some of it is in California. But I already told you, next week we're starting. Bill Russell directly is going to tell us what happened when his mother wore this dress and how did that contribute to them leaving Louisiana. That's what we're starting at next week. Here tomorrow for Neutralizing Workplace Racism. Got a teaspoon of that today. Go ahead, Mr. Charlie. The real Mr. Charlie. Much obliged for all the folks who joined in. Hope it was worthy of your, what is it, Thursday evening. So, heard it today. That was one vice I think we heard from Mr. Charlie. No alcohol. Sobriety would be best. Smoking and all the rest of it. We need high functioning brain computers, lots of logic, super logic, to get this problem solved. If you're out and about, you see someone being hostile and rowdy, exit. You don't know if they're armed, club, bat, whatever the case may be. If you're in a vehicle, you are, hey, same thing we heard from Mr. Charlie. Gotta harass the Negro motorist. Some things have not changed. Sober, buckled, not on your mobile device. They didn't have that problem way back then. That said, Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with other black people, victims of white supremacy. We ask that you help us remain patient with ourselves. Remind us to demonstrate the highest levels of black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with another black person. It has been time. Replace white supremacy with justice immediately. Cow signing out. Thanks all for tuning in. No name calling.
Nigga, you so brainwashed.
I'm a victim, your brother.
Problem. You're a victim.
I'm a victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my conditioning.
Mm-hmm.
Even my conditioning has been conditioned.